areas post-pandemic while maintaining social sustainability and wellness of urban population. Starting off with the background, we look back into the existence of urban parks. In the 19th century, Industrial Revolution led to massive urbanization, which in turn led to skyrocketing of population of large cities. The everyday lives of many citizens were a combination of poor quality of life, unhealthy conditions, and restricted access to areas with trees or vegetation. This decline increased public awareness of the importance of introducing green spaces and natural elements in urban contexts. Thus, in the 20th century, the term urban parks came into existence, which is today a vital part of urban ecosystem network. It benefits urban communities not only environmentally, but also aesthetically, recreationally, and economically. People started to realize the importance of open public spaces in their lifestyle, which forced the cities to have balance between open and green spaces, thus leading to the urban park movement. The evolution of urban green spaces in and around Delhi NCR can be seen in these maps, where green have been kept increasing over time, following the trends from the West. In today's world, the inclusion of urban parks is one of the mandatory norms that city planners and architects need to abide by whenever planning a new town or city. According to the World Urbanization Prospect Report of 2014, today, 54% of the world's population lives in urban areas, a proportion that is expected to increase by 66% by 2050. Coming to the 21st century, COVID-19 has created a huge impact on physical, mental, and social well-being of people around the globe. People stuck inside their homes have very little physical activity as well as social interaction, which not only affect their physical health, but also contribute to the deterioration of their mental well-being. Now I would like to invite my colleague Ria to continue from here.
Thank you, Simran. As we all know, newspapers at the peak time of the pandemic were full of people's distress as to how COVID has taken a toll on their mental and physical health. The Field COVID Survey conducted in February-March 2020 with around 1,000 people across 64 cities reported that a third of the respondents faced significant psychological impact because of COVID-19. Another study suggested that more than 50% of children had experienced agitation and anxiety during the lockdown. The anxieties described earlier have been overwhelming for people with pre-existing mental health conditions. This has created a domino effect in this deteriorating wellness. Which makes us ask this question, how does one tackle this deterioration of wellness? To achieve wellness, we need to first understand what exactly is wellness. WHO defines wellness as the optimal state of health of individuals and groups, and wellness is expressed as a positive approach to living. The primary difference between health and wellness is that health is the goal and wellness is the active process of achieving it. You truly cannot have health without first achieving wellness. While the focus of the widespread pandemic is the impacts on people's lives and economic well-being around the world, it is important to note that the pandemic has drastically limited people's available options for outdoor physical activities. During the pandemic, parks and urban green spaces have drawn attention back due to their significant functions, such as provision for healthy outdoor recreation, as well as serving as a green buffer area to maintain favorable health and quality of life. When asked about the usage of public space during the pandemic, 65% of the people appreciated the public spaces around them. Many of them admitted to attain a greater appreciation for these public spaces, while others listed out the benefits they felt in the daily life. The other 35% also realized the importance of going out, but couldn't go out because of the problems in their personal lives or the amenities provided to them, thus providing the need to use open spaces to counter the impact that in this instance being urban parks. Literally defined as a park in cities and other incorporated places that offer recreation and green space to residents of and visitors to an urban setting. Urban parks can be distinguished into three broad categories. Large city or cultural parks, which were a result of rapid urbanization and industrialization, which aimed to replicate the rural setting to create a familiar background for the migrants. Neighborhood parks that were created to address social and health concerns to provide easy access to open or recreational space in multiple areas of a city. And finally, pocket parks. As cities grew, urban land prices and open space was at a premium, which made it difficult to create large parks or even neighborhood parks, despite the desire to provide park space for residents. Hence, pocket parks came into existence. From these different urban settings, we looked at our limitations, which restricted us to collect the primary data. The two major limitations were COVID-19 and the limited availability of time. To tackle these limitations effectively and have efficient data collection, we chose to study urban neighborhood parks. These limitations also led us to the scope of the study, which deals with the social benefits of urban parks in the geographical location of Delhi NCR. Hence, we put forward the question, what is the role of an urban neighborhood park in the development of physical, mental, and social well-being of the community post-pandemic? And what are the different elements which make it socially sustainable? Now, I would like to invite my colleague Himani to continue from here.
Thank you, Ria. The primary research methods which aid the study are conducting primary case studies, referring to the literature review, and acquiring the first-hand information from interviews. The major aim of conducting primary research was to collect data and analyze the condition, usage, and effects of urban parks in the post-COVID urban context. The case study focused on three sites that lie in the same geographical zone but have different site conditions to create an understanding over a much larger domain. The first case study, the neighborhood parks taken up was in the middle of plotted residential typology. Per capita green of the area has been identified to be 33.08 meters square per capita. For the second case study, the park in the middle of high-rise tower with up to 20 stories high towers, per capita green of the area has been identified to be 1.8 meters square per capita. The third case study, the neighborhood park taken up was in the mixed-use settlement with both residential and commercial typology. Per capita green of the area has been identified to be 25.4 meters square per capita. Now, I would like to invite my colleague Nishant to continue from here.
Thank you, Imani. Now, talking about benefits of urban parks. Benefits of urban parks can be divided into five broad categories. Firstly, talking about benefits on physical health. Physical activity is proven to provide not only a longer lifespan, but also a more fit and healthier lifestyle. Urban neighborhood greens act as one of the most flexible spaces for any physical activity, from yoga to sports like cricket and football to children's games. Urban parks provide a large variety of activities for all age groups. Greens do stimulate the user's psychology, which in turn promotes physical health. Approximately 40% of the studies in which environmental characteristics were measured showed that parks provided an environment for children to perform different physical activities. People's chances of developing ailments, including cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and some types of cancer, can be considerably reduced. When diabetics are exposed to bright natural light on a regular basis, their vitamin D levels rise and their blood sugar levels fall. People that are exposed to a natural environment have been shown to have lower stress levels. Physical health has always been a point of concern for people, but since COVID struck, physical health has increased its significance in people's lives. During an interview, when asked if they visited for any kind of physical activity, the parks, people stated they need to visit parks for physical fitness, as closed spaces like gyms risk the transmission of the virus. Secondly, benefits regarding social aspects. Urban green spaces provide residents with not only daily contact with nature, but also recreational and educational opportunities. Furthermore, studies indicate that they provide great aesthetic enjoyments to the residents. Parks also help foster social interactions. Places like high-rise buildings separate the residents, which result in social disconnect, as crowded urban contexts further make productive social contact difficult. Urban neighborhood parks provide the residents with a more preferable environment for social interactions. old people and children living near such parks have much more social ties than others. Also, a sense of community can be created when frequently using outdoor green spaces. When asked about the reason for visiting the park, some people express their state of mind while being inside the park. Now, I would like to invite my colleague Yash to continue from here.
Thank you, Nishant. Talking about benefits of urban parks on the psychological well-being of a person. Open green spaces contribute directly to public health by reducing stress and mental disorders, increasing the effect of physical activity, reducing health inequalities, increasing satisfaction of living environment and social interactions. Our primary survey also suggested that a majority of people visited the parks for relaxation and stress relief. All these indicators corresponding well to the definition of health established by the World Health Organization. Open nature fulfills important immaterial human needs. People visit nature because they want to relax, to escape from the stressful rhythms of the city, to the routine of everyday life, and to experience silence and beauty. Public parks constitute a sort of an oasis in the city where people can engage into social relationships in a tranquil and safe atmosphere. Modern day research verifies that the fact that urban parks and forests can reduce stress levels in individuals and can be therapeutic for their mental health and well-being. It was noted in the primary survey that relaxation is an important need fulfilled in nature along with fascination, beauty, peace, and freedom. As it can be seen in the graph, people visiting parks for relaxation and mental peace increased dramatically post the pandemic. Furthermore, discussing about the impacts of urban parks upon the environment and climate. The benefits of urban green spaces are not just environmental. They also encompass the provision of employment and by cleaning and cooling urban air quality. Urban green spaces are extremely necessary, particularly in developing countries like India, where air pollution levels are extremely high. With the increasing growth of artificial urban pavements made of asphalt and concrete, there's a difference in the thermal, optical, and geometrical properties that makes the urban context hotter than the rural areas all over the world as they are experiencing the urban heat island effect. The increase in temperature caused due to the urban heat island effect impacts the thermal comfort conditions, increases the pollutant concentrations, and relatively intensifies the energy consumption for cooling. Along with this, it also has great impacts on the urban ecosystem, making it an environmental issue on a global scale and with the plausibility of worsening global warming. Lastly, discussing about the socioeconomic benefits of urban parks, parks not only affect the people, but also affect the economy of the urban context. The proximity of parks to a locality plays a huge role in defining the economical and real estate value of the locality. Homebuyers prefer homes close to parks, open spaces, and greenery. Proximity to parks increases property value, thereby increasing property tax revenue. Research has shown that a 5% increase in the property values for houses that are within 150 meters of a park is a conservative estimate of the change in property value due to the proximity of a park. Parks decrease health costs and support productivity both through encouraging exercise and reducing air pollution. The common conception about green spaces is that they need to exist without need for economic justification. But the truth is that the benefits of urban green spaces are amongst life's intangible necessities whose benefits are difficult to quantify. They contribute towards the social dynamics like well-being, livability, etc., which in turn aids towards the betterment of society. In other words, it is not a direct link, rather an indirect one regarding improvement of the society in general. Now, I would like to call my colleague Arjun to continue from here.
Thank you, Yash. So the primary case studies conducted by us led us to the following analysis. Ghaziabad, Delhi NCR. Physical health. The presence of proper jogging tracks and dedicated play area attracted people to visit the park to work on their physical health. The lack of amenities like an open gym could be felt, although a futsal ground is being developed, which would provide users with more reasons to visit. Social well-being. Clusters of seating spaces and gazebos provide a good spot for social interactions between friends and family. proper maintenance of amenities aids in building a strong community factor, but due to the COVID guidelines, there is a decrease in community activities. Psychological benefits. A sudden change in the built environment from a dense, low-rise plotting to a large open green area tranquilizes the mind and releases stress. The park being well maintained with proper lighting and security and being surrounded by residences helps user feel safe and at ease. Achnara Daffodils, Noida. Physical health. The park does not have any physical exercise equipment like open gym, so the younger generation prefers going to the basketball and badminton court present in the society as a part of their daily exercise routine, whereas the well-maintained jogging tracks are beneficial for walking and jogging. Social well-being. The society park being centrally located makes it an ideal gathering space for different festivities and community events. Hence, this park has a very strong social element tied to it, as the park is an indispensable part of the residents' life for any and every cultural event from different regions of the country. Psychological benefits. Post-COVID, the number of people visiting the parks for mental relaxation and stress busting increased dramatically as the society parks became one of the few places for the working class to take a break from their work schedule and relax their minds. New Friends Colony, South Delhi. Physical health. As a significant chunk of the parkland is dedicated to an open gym, more respondents were shown visiting this park for their physical health and fitness. That being said, the lack of maintenance of jogging tracks made the activities like jogging and walking difficult for the users. Social well-being. Since this is a public park, the presence of a strong commercial context promotes people from varied social backgrounds to visit. The amenities present in the park caters to all age groups except young kids due to the absence of dedicated play area. Psychological benefits. Being next to a commercial complex, the park receives a lot of noise, hence people prefer visiting the park during early mornings for mental relaxation and stress busting. Scattered shady spaces around the park, lack of proper security and maintenance renders the use of the park unsafe during late hours of the day. So the challenges of overuse on one hand and exclusion on other raise important questions for future investment in parks and green spaces. COVID-19 has emphasized the many functions parks serve within a community, and all of them are important, from providing a space for nature to offering opportunities to play or sit quietly or take part in social or therapeutic activities. While it should be noted that outdoor activities increase the risk of infection, but long-term isolation may bring out more health problems. Therefore, this goes without saying that users should take preventive measures like setting aside time for outdoor activities, wearing masks, keeping a distance of at least 2 meters from others, and avoiding direct contact for more than 15 minutes. These basic amenities like open gym, proper lighting, public washrooms, etc., not only proves as incentives, but also encourage people by providing them a safe and well-maintained environment. All these amenities prove to be just a medium to achieve the ultimate goal of all suggestions being wellness. Planners and landscape architects will have the duty to consider the functions of city parks during pandemics. They need to facilitate the residents' safe usage of parks, beginning right from the doorsteps, as they prove to be the best bet for every individual's social sustainability. In short, no one desires another pandemic, but active preparation is always the right choice should such an event occur again. We would now like to culminate our research with the thought that the occurrence of pandemics is inevitable, but awareness and preparedness makes all the difference. Thank you.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury members to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to post their questions in the chat box.
You want to go, Sudipto?
Sir, you're on mute, sir.
Sorry about that. I do this often. Firstly, I would say that your presentation was much better than your document which you had sent earlier. the flow was better, the arguments were kind of more connected, and it seems like you had more time doing that. Is that right? Possibly, right? And you had about 12 weeks to do this. So I can understand the constraints and that you had. I just had a few questions regarding how you gathered the data. If you could also tell me about the per capita green that you calculated, how did you do that? What was the method for doing that?
About how did we gather the data? We conducted primary case studies, like we visited.
That's a second question I will ask you. But firstly, I wanted to ask you about the per capita green. How did you calculate that?
So it was a round of estimation based on the houses that we could spot through the satellite image, and through our surveys, we also asked a question that how many members are there in your family. So averaging out that data from the survey, and multiplying it with the number of houses, we got the total population of that locality, and then we also found the area of the green space of that locality, and that is how we were able to find the per capita green.
Right. It would be easy for the Noida apartment complex, I can imagine, but for New Friends Colony and for the other one.
Yes, sir. I understand your concern that that green space area is not just confined to people coming only from those areas around it, but other people also do come in. But somewhere we had to set a line, so as to draw a comparative analysis between the different cases and draw conclusions. So that was one of the limitations, and that is how that was the process that we followed for our
right.
case study.
And did you? I know that you drew conclusions from, let's say, a park which has got more social relevance, like in Noida, but people are they're more comfortable going to those parks as against a park in a place like New Friends Colony, for example. But was there a relationship that you drew from the per capita information to the perception of the parks? I mean, how the parks were perceived, because more people are using it, or less people, or people had less per capita park area. Was there a relationship that you could derive from there?
If I talk about the per capita green area, so I feel people having more, personally speaking, what we found through the survey was that if the park was, larger, if the per capita was greater, people tend to visit the parks more in that case. I mean, it has a different perception compared to a place like Noida, where it's like a high density residence area, and it's just a park which is sits right in the middle of the towers. So it's a different case as such, but not anything strikingly different like that we could point out specifically related to per capita green in different cases.
So okay. To answer your question about the per capita greens, when we looked at the parks for over the timeline during the day, so what we found out was the, like Arjun mentioned, that Noida had a quite high density. So when we looked at that high density and compared it to the usage of the park, we found out that the usage of the park was limited to only the children and the more vulnerable groups who cannot go outside. So when people had the chance of going outside, like in early mornings, when people are generally going out for a walk, people are preferring to go over on the roads that is there right outside the society rather than inside the park. And that is due to the comparison between the density of the society and the size of the park, directly relating to the per capita green.
Right. When we were doing seminar several years back, I was part of a couple of them, and there was a certain mandate of making it a little bit more controversial, right? Where there would be, you immediately take a for or against position. You become a little bit, it becomes a little bit dichotomous in some ways, the topics. And the whole idea was to get a discussion going, to make people think about the topic. Now, this is a topic that almost seems like, you know, it's a no-brainer in some ways, that obviously, you know, parks are great. Obviously, it even before COVID, you know, we knew this information. So there was a lot of stuff in the in your presentation which I thought you could have omitted, such as the history of parks and what kind of parks, because, you know, in some ways people know about that, and rather focused on the things that we really want to talk about, which is after COVID, how has the perception of parks really, really changed? And what has been a remarkable discovery for you during this journey of your seminar? If you could just bring it out in a nutshell for me and for the other others on this panel, if you could just let us know, what was that one revelation that you did not know about when you went into this study?
So one thing that was, I feel, very surprising was that people, like when we went to visit the parks after the pandemic, we thought there would be a decline, you know, in people coming to parks, and it would be, you know, like almost a deserted place with little to no people roaming around and like just children playing around here and there. But we found out that more and more people, you know, they were not aware of what has happened to them during the pandemic. It was a near-death experience for all of us. It was a, you know, it was an unprecedented time, and we could actually feel that where we were lacking in terms of our personal, physical and mental health. So when we lose something, when we feel that, you know, we are losing something, then we realize the importance of that thing. That made people visit parks. And to confirm this, we actually interviewed all these questions to them, and these were the answers that they themselves told us. Like, now people are more, now we are more, you know, concerned about our health and our physical and mental health compared to before the pandemic. Like, even why to go far, even if I talk about my family, my father is now more concerned and he does not miss his morning walks. So I think it's a common trend that has been observed. So that was surprising to me when I went and, you know, interviewed the people, and their perception has changed, and they started addressing these problems that now we need to work on this. And usually people just, you know, talk about it and don't take actions on their thoughts, but now after going through that experience, they're actually going to the parks and, you know, working on their physical health and mental and all the factors that you mentioned.
Also not surprising, I'm sorry to say, it's not surprising that that's the truth. I mean, it is going to be like that, right? If you have, you know, you're spending more time at home, you're working from home more, you will visit the parks more. But one of the data that I found kind of interesting was, how often do you visit the park pre-COVID and post-COVID? And if you can bring up that chart on the screen, I just want to say something there. You know, this one, I don't know if you can see my, this one here, this one, this data, can you bring that up?
Just a minute.
Yeah.
Which locality is that, sir?
Any one of them. What's interesting is that the change of pre-COVID to post-COVID for daily users is minimal. You know, it's, I don't know which one, I think this is Ghaziabad. It's 17.6% to 18.2%. It's like 0.6% increase. But increase of occasional visitors has gone up considerably. So for monthly visitors, it's gone from 5.9 to 18.7%. And what does that tell you? I mean, that's something that you should have picked up on, really, that there is something is going on, that people who visited parks regularly are still visiting. You know, there's no change. But people who would visit, who are less conscious, are now becoming more conscious about their health. People who are, you know, and I think that's something that should have been a little bit of a consideration in your inferences, as would be also my, I'm trying to understand, because I see that there are in the survey result, there is I'm again going to pick it up because you're not bringing it up on the screen.
Sorry, I'm just searching for it.
If you can see that there are no results for people who have never visited the park or are never visiting the park, which means that obviously they have been left out of your sample set, which also points to a fact that, you know, you're asking people who eat meat about the benefits of eating meat, right? And you've got to ask people who don't eat meat what the benefits of eating meat might have been. So people who visit parks, obviously they're going to tell you visiting parks are great, but you have to have people in your sample set who don't visit parks at all, right? So this one, the monthly thing has gone up substantially, but there's no set for never. So daily, weekly, monthly, occasionally, and never. So occasionally 0% means that there are no people who never visit parks, which is also surprising. I'm sure there are people who never visit parks, right? You've got to have those guys in your surveys.
Right.
That's something, would have probably, because I am trying to get to the bottom of how things have changed, and I'm still not very, very, the revelations are not out there yet for me. And I think you've done the work, you've got your surveys. You could have, of course, a larger sample set. That's always possible. You had the limitations of time. But even with your results, I think there is more digging that you can do to get at better inferences.
Thanks.
Okay, I had some observations and some suggestions. So the first being that it seems that the parks and the open space has now come in focus with the pandemic for a research topic like yours. And maybe we are looking at case studies of the parks and its relevance for the lifestyle that we are used to, or the kind of house type that we live in, where all of us have our own space any which way within the house. So the examples that you have chosen are all of a certain housing societies or of a certain kind of grade of housing. The moment you were to take it away from this set of economic group or the kind of colonies we are looking at, you will find that the whole data, you will come to a situation where you're looking at the parks as a very different commodity rather than the factors that you have been analyzing it under, where you're only looking at it as a recreation or a healthy space, etc., which is a choice-based activity. The moment you take it away and you look at a park, now, I'm just thinking aloud because while I was reading this, I was looking at it and saying that, okay, why have I started going to the parks in the pandemic? Because I had time, or I was conscious of not going to the gym and I need to go to the park to gym or for a walk, etc. So, it is, when we're looking at it from our prism, that's one way of looking at it. But the moment you step out and look at a colony or a house which has only one room with six people, does the park have a completely different relevance? And is it only for the pandemic, or is it on a daily basis that they use the park in a certain way? And my observation of just as a city dweller who walks into the colonies where I don't live, but they are much denser, the parks have a completely different relevance. And the park is not really a park. The government or the authorities have made it like a park, but it doesn't function like the park we understand parks as. And it works like a drawing room, it works like a school, it works like a picnic spot, it works like a lunch room. So you'll find different varieties of usage. And if you were to kind of look into that aspect, it might reveal much more and bring out a discussion which is more, like Sudhita was saying, that it will bring out the kind of a very varied sense of space and how we should analyze our space in India, where we are dealing with we are dealing with the typology of park, which we understand, like you've explained in the history of parks, but that is not the way things pan out. So that's one suggestion, that you can look at parks in a different light. Pandemic, yes. And has pandemic really made any change to those parks, which are never thought of as recreational spaces, but as extension of homes, you know, where people are spreading out and sunning themselves or eating lunch, or because they just don't have enough space within their house. Now, you'll find a lot of these examples in Kalkaji, in Malviya Nagar, or in areas which are with smaller homes. So that's one. Second is I think, yes, if you can bring in this aspect of what a typical park design, like your focus was really on the park design, that you had taken it as a constant that the parks have been made in a certain way and they offer certain things to the colony around. Is there any other, internationally, if you were to look at some examples of parks or open spaces and how they tie up with the neighborhood, and what are the other examples possible for this kind of interaction of people to the open space? Whether you want to term it as a park or a walking edge or a pedestrian zone. So I think the definition of the park can be expanded to include all of this and make it a more human interactive area, which is non-vehicular. And in the pandemic, a lot of people were walking on the streets because there were no cars. You know, it was a great revelation that, you know, we could, that whole, that entire urban space for pedestrians is opened up. And do therefore parks have to be gated and walled the way we understand it today? And that whatever happens inside the park is another activity, and whatever happens outside is another activity. You know, so that there is that also, which exists in our, at least in Delhi, it exists very clearly. And the parks get locked up and opened up, you know, and they'll get open up at 6 a.m. and they get locked up in the evening. So that the whole definition of park is defined by that exclusive space. So you can look at it not as an exclusive space in our society and make it, how is it more inclusive? So these are two suggestions which I have, which you could include in your thesis. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for your comments, sirs, and we thank the team for their presentation. I request Joanne to introduce the next team.
Thank you, Tilak. So moving on to the next topic, impact of COVID-19 on the hotel industry, which discusses how the hospitality industry has been massively affected by the COVID-19 pandemic, economically as well as emotionally. We would now like to invite the final group of the presentation around the primary theme of pandemic.
Thank you, Joanne. A hearty morning to everyone. I am Abhi Bilala, and let me introduce you to my team members. Gauri Shetty Aditi, Bompelli Sai Ruthvik Rao, Samyu TM, and Wangari Rahul. Our guide for this topic is architect Suneet Paul. The COVID-19 is an ongoing health crisis that has affected the health of millions. However, the novel virus has not only caused a health crisis, but is also responsible for an unprecedented socio-economic turmoil. The hospitality industry. What is the hospitality industry? The hospitality industry, which comprises of the hotel, travel, recreational, tourism, and the food and beverages sector, is considered the backbone for economic growth, especially in developing countries. However, COVID-19 in India has significantly affected the hospitality and tourism sector. Global and domestic tourists have cancelled their programs to visit the natural, historical, religious, and cultural sites. The flight tickets and the hotel reservations have been cancelled. A significant number of workers in the sector had lost their jobs. Since the different industries in the hospitality industry are dependent on each other on a daily basis, the effect of the pandemic on the hospitality industry scaled up. The hotel industry. The world is still coming to terms with the COVID-19 outbreaks, and there is no doubt that the pandemic has reached has changed the world as we know it. The overall impact on human life, economic growth, and businesses was immeasurable, both in short and long term, due to the uncertainty as things evolved. The Indian hotel sector had been hit hard, grappling with significant low demand with very low bookings. Even after the lockdown, the hotels were not given the permission to become operational. So, what is the most difficult challenge the hotel industry faced during the pandemic? What were the innovations the hotel industry came up with during these difficult times? How has the hotel industry tackled this disaster? And what are the changes they are making for the future disaster, if they were to face any? So let us get these questions answered. Now, I request Ruthvik to take over and explain the secondary case study.
Thank you, Abhi. Now I'm going to talk about one of the leading Indian hotel brand, IHCL. Indian Hotels Company Limited. IHCL is a multinational hotel brand with a strong heritage and rich legacy of 100 plus years, with 221 hotels and 400 plus restaurants spread over 12 plus countries, 100 plus locations. IHCL owns many brands like Taj, Vivanta, and SeleQtions, and many more. The reason we chose IHCL is because of its domination in Indian hotel industry. As of January 2021, IHCL was the leading hotel company in India in terms of market capitalization, with over 147 billion Indian rupees. How else can we judge a business of a company other than its financial report? To analyze the impact of COVID-19 on IHCL, we further studied the financial details of the company, revenue of the company. In the past few years, it was around 4,000 to 4,600 crores. It experienced a drastic fall of 60% in the financial year 2020-21 to reach 1,739.88 crores. It is even worse when it comes to the profits after tax. Being an industry leader, IHCL was experiencing constant growth in its profits in the past 4 years to reach yearly profit of 354 crores in 2019-20. The higher you are, more you are going to get hurt when you fall. From there, it fell down to rock bottom of 720 crores of loss, which is 300% fall from the previous year. Revenue per available room, RevPAR, is a metric used in the hospitality industry to measure hotel performance. IHCL always performed better than the market's average. Along with the whole market, even IHCL experienced a downfall of 60%. After studying these numbers perspective of the impact, to get a human perspective to our study, we looked into the employees data. When it comes to the number of employees, IHCL had around 29,000 employees in its Indian hotels in 2019-20. Around 4,500 internationally. But due to the pandemic in India, around 7,000 employees, that is 24% of the total employees, lost their job. Internationally, it was around 1,000 employees, which is 21%. 24% of the total employees lost their job. 60% downfall in the revenue. 300% downfall in the profits after tax. This huge was the impact on the company, which is the leader of the hotel industry. But how did they respond to this disaster? Well, they did their changes and innovations to bounce back. As physical touch plays a major role in the virus transmission from one person to another, people started sanitizing surroundings to eliminate this probability. Going a step ahead of everyone, IHCL started using zero contact service for the customers by its iGest scheme. Zero touch service transformation. This was done by implementing innovative methods like zero touch check-ins, checkouts, digital menus, online payments. Going further away, they came up with a scheme named Reset 2020. Revenue growth, R stands for revenue growth, excellence in guest well-being, experience and operations, spend optimization, effective asset management, thrift and financial prudence. This is an integrated program implemented by IHCL across all its hotel to get back to its normal position. Maybe to get back to the new normal, which we all are aspiring to see. That's it about IHCL. Now Aditi will continue with our other case study. Thank you.
Thank you, Rakhit. Now I'm going to talk about the next case study, Lemon Tree Hotels. Lemon Tree Hotels is an Indian hotel chain. It is India's largest hotel chain in the mid-priced hotel sector. The Lemon Tree Hotels has 7 brands working under it, which range from economy to upscale. The COVID-19 outbreak imposed massive issues for the hotel sector, forcing travel to a pause. Given the particular events, Lemon Tree Hotel came up with a plan to protect the health and safety of its staff, partners, and consumers. 1. For home quarantine cases, medical expenses, including oxygen if required, was provided. 2. For hospitalization cases, in severe cases, additional expenses beyond the insured amount. 3. Free hotel stays and medicines for employees who need to isolate themselves. All vaccination expenses for employees and their families and their dependents was given. Compensation in the unfortunate case where an employee passes away, graded plan based on tenure in the company. Additionally, the employee's child will be trained or employed by the company if requested by the family. 3 weeks paid leave for all employees who test positive for COVID-19. Next. As we see in the graphs, occupancy levels, revenue from operations and cash profit and RevPAR has drastically decreased in the financial year 2021. And as we see by the end of, and they have observed that by the end of financial year 2021, they have witnessed improvement in occupancy levels and higher bookings led by a sustained recovery in markets and sequential improvements in consumption of the leisure front. And additionally, they have seen improved demand coming for weddings, staycations, and work from hotels and social events. Their chairman and managing director took a 100% salary cut, whereas senior management team took a cut ranging from 50 to 66%. And additionally, other employees were encouraged to take leave to spend time with the family while the business regained momentum and stability. The Lemon Tree Hotels has identified the main key demand drivers for the business to run. And they are the first, business travel. So the business travel includes both inbound and outbound visits for the business objectives. And this part is a huge source for interest for accommodation in business-oriented regions, including Gurugram, Bangalore, Hyderabad, and Pune. This interest has been affected as a result of reduced mobility imposed by the government. 2. Leisure travel. Vacation travel, including short-term vacations, is included in leisure travel. 3. MICE demand. The MICE category is mostly corporate-driven, consisting of conferences, training programs, and other customer-facing and interactive events. 4. Weddings and social travel. Domestic travel for wedding destinations and most common types of wedding and social travel. Such demand will most likely gravitate towards the hotels that have the required function facilities. 5. Airlines and airline crew. This demand set aids to creation of a core demand of hotels, although at considerably reduced cost. Crew demand may originate from both international and domestic carriers, while big international airlines would prefer upper-tier hotels. 6. Transit demand. Transit demand might arise on both arrival and departure of international and domestic travel between locations interlinked by a regional hub. Now I would like to call my colleague Soumya to continue with the international case study.
So yeah, thank you, Aditi. So we did an international case study on a hotel called DeChai Hotel Group. It is a local large-scale hotel group in Chai Mang City in Thailand. So in this study, we have looked into the impact and the recovery strategy followed by the hotel during the crisis. And the statistical report says that the government faced the economic shrinkage in GDP by 2% and in the year 2020 after 6 years. The tourism went 40% down due to this and hotel was shut down. Among few, DeChai Hotel was performing good. As you can see in the graph, the room occupancy percent went drastically down from Jan to March, and it clearly shows that the hotel recovered from the downfall successfully. The hotel states that the labor cost, marketing cost, and the operations and the maintenance cost as their major impact. The second graph clearly shows that the rise and fall of the
the number of full-time workers. So the main reason of the recovery was the paid quarantine service. During the lockdown, the hotel volunteered to do paid quarantine service. It is a collaborative act of government and private sector to provide paid quarantine service due to the insufficient facility, staff, and comfort accommodation. This is mutually benefited to both the parties, and this reduces the pressure of health sector as well as to provide comfort for those who are willing to pay. And during the recovery period, some new business opportunities have opened up in some fields like sanitation and health department, collaborative network growth, employee training program and cost control, employees adaptation, and in the promotional strategy for address game. Thank you. Now I request Rahul to take over.
Yeah, thank you, Samyu. So now I'm going to present a transcript from an interview which we have done with a manager who works in JW Marriott. So through this interview, we got a direct insight into the working of a hotel industry during the pandemic. What is the most difficult challenge hotels faced during the pandemic, and what was the business for the hotels during the lockdown period? So the hotel industry is one of the first sectors to get affected by any sensitive situation in the current world. Any of the sensitive moments affect the hotel industry, since people prefer staying in their homes and not risking their lives during any natural or man-made disasters. Particularly, like, for example, the hotels which are located at tourist destinations or islands, which relied entirely on tourists, were badly affected because of the zero tourist movement caused by the pandemic. And many of these hotels had to be shut down temporarily or permanently. The business which the hotels had was different in different phases. For example, in phase one, which is during the first wave of the pandemic, there was almost zero business due to the lockdown imposed by the government. And during the phase two, which is during the lifting up of the lockdown, there were few corporate customers who were accommodating their employees in these high-end hotels. And there were also international clients who had to quarantine themselves for 14 days. And most of them preferred high-end hotels. And this was the only business they had during the second phase. What measures did hotels follow for guest safety? Having a clean hotel is one of the most important factors in gaining customers' loyalty. Depending on the hotel and the services offered, there may be unique features and require a specialty cleaning solution. The hotels have started a more sophisticated sanitization process for the hotel rooms after the customers left. They also came up with a new policy of keeping the rooms ideal for 24 hours after the guest checkout. This also reduces chance of virus transmission in the hotel and also encourages customers to get into the hotels. And when it comes to the food and beverage sector in hotels, buffet system was temporarily removed and seating capacity has been reduced by 50% to promote social distancing. They've also come up with a few innovative innovations, like they introduced online food menus and the digitalization for checking of the customers instead of hard copies of the documents during the entry. This was done to minimize the touch and as much as possible. They also were sanitizing key cards using UV rays. What was the impact on the employees working in this hotel sector? So in JW Marriott, there were few people who were from a different place, and when the pandemic hit, they wanted to get back to their hometown. So the hotel has given them an option to either go to their hometown or to the stay back. So employees who were willing to stay back in the hotel and work during the pandemic were provided various services and facilities by the hotel within the hotel premise. So the hotel employees get to stay in the hotel and they do not have to travel back and forth their homes, and to cut down the transportation of the employees to maintain the safety. This in turn reduces the touch points by keeping the employees in the hotels. And in JW Marriott, it was decided by the administration ki that they're gonna decrease the salary by 50%. And they thought this would be a better idea than removing people from the job. But there were also other hotels where they have decided to lay off few employees. By doing this, they have managed to reduce both the maintenance costs and also reduce the chance of virus transmission within the hotel premise. What is the difference between the impact of COVID-19 on luxury hotel brands and budget hotels? Was it a blessing in disguise for the luxury hotels? The revenue of both luxury and budget hotels has been brought down drastically by the pandemic, but the luxury hotels have more costing in managing a particular property compared to a budget hotel. For the luxury hotel brand, the moment the rates have been slashed during the pandemic, for example, if a property whose rate was ₹6,000 per day pre-pandemic, the rate has been reduced by 50% to 3,000 during the pandemic. So the people that were earlier visiting the mid-range hotels will definitely choose the luxury hotel brands because they're getting more value against the price they're willing to pay. While the mid-range hotels reduce their prices to 1500 per night, the customer base changed between the hotel companies, and the low-budget hotels have to face the maximum impact because it has very less scope of reducing the fare of the property. In the end, the customers who got to visit the hotels at very cheap price were at the advantages end.
How long do you think it will take for this situation to become normal? So industry is trying to adapt to this new normal. People are being careful and even hotels are taking the safety measures. It has been over a year since it all started. This is getting better every day. With everyone started to live with this, everyone in the hotel premises is being responsible enough to carry their own sanitizers and wear masks. With time, even the financial graphs started to rise. As you can see on screen, the RevPAR of domestic hotels of IHCL increased in each quarter. This is the graph of 4 quarters. So in this way, if this continues, the situation should be normal in less than 2 years from now. So, and I request Abhi to conclude this.
All right. The key points derived from the research are: the hotel industry was adversely affected by the COVID-19 pandemic in all aspects in the initial lockdown period. The low budget hotels were the ones to get the most affected by the pandemic in the hotel industry. Since the luxury hotel brands initially had very high fares, they had greater scope to cut down the fare and still be profitable. But the low budget hotels had very little scope to cut down their already cheap prices, making them lose the customers to mid-range hotels. On the other hand, the customers got to visit the hotels at a very cheap price, and the customers were the ones to get the most of the advantage. Employees working in the hotel industry were affected partially or completely depending on the hotel they served in. The entire hotel management took a 50% pay cut in a few hotels, while in a few hotels, 50% employees lost their jobs and the rest did not have a single rupee cut from the salary. Talking about a few positive impacts, in order to meet the minimum requirements for COVID-19 safety, utmost importance was given towards hygiene. The hotel premises were kept clean and regularly sanitized. Some of the staff even carried their own pen to minimize the physical contact. Technology and digital applications were used right from check-in into the hotel to unlocking a room. Also, the hotel industry reacted very positively in the time of need, at the time of emergency, to lend out their premises to the hospitals and for the COVID-19 patients to be used as quarantine centers. Of course, after the COVID-19 pandemic, the hotel industry will be better equipped from this experience if any pandemic gets stuck in the future. Now, I would like to conclude by quoting Nathan Keevy, CEO of Hoteliers Company. We don't know where this will end, but history shows a resilience and ability to bounce back swiftly in hospitality. In the short term, we understand we are all going through the same difficulties. Look out for one another and help each other. Thank you.
Thank you, team, for that presentation. I would now like to request the jury to give their feedback and comments, and for the audience to post any questions that they may have in the chat.
Rahul, you want to go first?
Okay. So, you know, you will have researched on the hotel aspect of how hotels have bounced back or how they have tried to bounce back to this pandemic situation and what measures they have taken. I just find it, if you were to look at it as an architectural, you know, a thesis which can, or a research which can guide you to understand the architecture of the hotel and the design of the hotel and see what are the opportunities available there given the pandemic situation, then you may look at the hotel buildings as a typology that offer a certain value to the society. That is one, at the buildings as a typology. The second is the human resource that the hotel trains, the kind of the people whom you talked about, how the hotels are taking care of them, how they're taking care of the society, etc. So that there's it's a huge army of people, you know, and they're the most trained, because I have some friends there and we were chatting about it, how they were dealing with crisis situations, and they said they have crisis every day. So for a hotel, it's like a city within a city, you know. When you go to a hotel, a big hotel, it is like an ecosystem in itself, and they are dealing with crisis every day. So if you were to look at their teams and their systems, it's almost like the army or the forces, you know, which are all, they have their own systems. So that is something that is greatly one the society can rely on. Third is there's a huge link between hospitality and hospitals. So if you look at the typology of the building, the how it is planned, how it is serviced, you know, there is a certain generic value to service oriented, service to the for guests, you know, where the guests could be patients and they are their luxury. So there is a certain linkage you can build up if you were to look at it more critically. And if you were to look at hospital design, then you'll find that it also is informed greatly nowadays by hospitality. Because you're looking at comfort, luxury, peace of mind, you know, so all these things are inbuilt as given. And high-end hospitals do that now. So is there a way, and the hotels also are looking at therapy, wellness, happiness, and all these factors beyond as part of luxury, as part of holiday, as part of, you know, de-stressing, this and the other. So, you know, so these are all, it's all packaged in a certain, they're all different packages with we are offered these and we pay up and we sign up for these things. But as an industry, as a building component, as a building typology, as architectural expression, these are institutions which we are building in our cities or in our, in even as resorts, etc. But if you were to look at them as social institutes, what do they offer us? What kind of resilience? Are they robust enough to convert themselves to something else? These are topics which this could have expanded into. And you will find that there might be many more things that you can start thinking about when you research. You just scratch the surface. And yes, you've mentioned that how hotel, I think what comes out of it, that the hotel industry produces an army of workers. It's got history, it's got a system in place. Maybe society doesn't tap into it and we only look at it as a luxury component where we have to shell out money. It's not that. They are available, and if you look at, there are many movies also made after 26/11, you know, how the Bombay hotels bounced back and how they were contributing to the society. If you look at hotel history of Sri Lanka, which was war stricken, you know, so how their hotels came back after that crisis. So after tsunamis, after the civil war. So, and these were countries which were largely dependent on tourism. So tourism, building types, people, kind of space they occupy, what does it offer to the society? These are large topics you can kind of expand your research onto. That is, because otherwise in your present research, I didn't find it linking up to an architectural understanding of what are you going to do with that kind of space. Somebody did mention that the buffet went out of style and you were serving a la carte, or, you know. So yes, those are the measures that one takes, but you know, there are many more things which can happen to make these places still relevant to visitors. And if you were to look at in history, these big social big institutions of the society, how do they change their relevance? Whether it's a church or a temple, if there's a flood or is there something else? So what happens to those places? Do they become something else? And do they still they then become more important? You know, there is much more standing of these institutions after the crisis. So think about it in that light. I think this research might open up some more avenues. Thanks.
Sure, sir.
Yeah, I was going to actually say that myself, that the type of the hotel and the hospital, you know, they're so similar that you've got to think about it typologically as an architect and think about how they have become different over time. And the idea of isolation versus togetherness, right? That this is almost a game that we had to play during this time of distancing and yet becoming closer. And so there was this whole idea of physicality built into the pandemic, and this idea of physicality, the idea of proximity, involves us as architects very deeply and in a manner that one must get into. One must be interested in this kind of an exploration where you look for opportunities to think of physical space as more than dimensions, but as psychological, as physiological, and so on. So I think Rahul has kind of laid the ground for that kind of inquiry that you need to kind of take this study to the next level. And so I will also now kind of perhaps look at, because this is also an exercise in research and how to do research and how to kind of, you know, make your research questions more pointed in how to kind of look at a bibliography and a literature survey and think about how you locate yourself within that literature survey, right? So, and I'm looking at your bibliography and I'm looking at a couple of these items where this is the survival of hotels during the COVID-19 pandemic, a critical case study in Vietnam. This is something that you've referred to. Then there is impact on the Indian hotel sector. This is Mandeep S. Lamba's study. There is another one, a case study of factors affecting the performance of the hotel industry of Chiang Mai in Thailand and the impact of COVID-19, taking Bichai Hotel Group as an example. And so I'm thinking that, you know, you've got a lot of this stuff already from your secondary sources. And so it puts a little bit of a responsibility on the researcher. How do I locate myself within this literature survey to figure out how I can do things differently or how I can bring my expertise to the table or look at my local case study, which is your J.W. Marriott interview, and figure out how this can be a kind of a study which makes a difference or takes it to another level. And I wanted to ask you whether you found something in your interview that led you to some place beyond these studies already there. I also saw that you had appendices, and these appendices had appendix A1 was a questionnaire for customer behavior during COVID-19. That A2 is customer behavior survey, and appendix B is people in hotel industry. What are these appendices doing? Are they what are these questionnaires? Did you use them? Why are they there in the study? Could you answer that for me? I also wanted to talk about the title because it's important. The title leads to a pointed research question or vice versa. And you've got the impact of COVID-19 on the hotel industry, studying the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on the organized hotel industry and response. So it's already kind of a little bit muddy in terms of what you mean and response. It also wants to ask you that, are you talking about urban hotels or destination hotels? You're not differentiated there. Are you talking about in India or not in India? Are you talking about, you've got to think about your study as something that's going to be referred to in, let's say, 50 years' time. And you want to kind of then have to say, which wave of COVID-19, okay, after the second wave, third wave, you don't know how many waves there might be. So, I mean, just to kind of locate this in a timeline of sorts as an academic work, which will, you know, which will be, which is part of a larger academic network of documents and research. So this is adding to that, and you've got that responsibility as researchers to ensure that you do it in a manner that's correct and proper. So I'll leave it at that. If you could just tell me about the appendices and whether you, those questions are your own, and also the first question, which was, how did you locate yourself in that literature survey that you did?
The appendix that we added at the end. So that was a Google Google survey that we carried out on our own. And that was distributed within the customers, like the clients who visit the hotel industry. So that was a survey. And the appendix B was the questions we asked to the people working in the industry. So that was the interview that was framed out of those questions primarily.
Okay, and I mean, the results, are you going to publish them somewhere? Are you going to summarize them anywhere?
Yeah, like the results also we have included it in the appendix A1. That was the first one was the survey by the questions, and the second one is the results and the inferences the results we got from the survey.
Well, in this document, it's not clear at all. It says more intense room in between stays. Question, answer is yes or no. Now, what is the answer? I mean, yes or no is, of course, it's a check box, but what's the result of the survey? Where is that?
Yeah.
So if you're going to do a job, then you know, bit better. Also, did you your manager? What was that telling you differently from the other research papers that you found online?
Yeah, a few things we saw differently was that. On the internet or on any other case study, we found an overall data, like how the industry is getting affected and how particular industries or particular hotel brands are getting affected. But through the interview, we came to know like the high-end hotels and the low-end hotels, they had a drastic difference between the impact. So like if we see, so the high-end hotels brands were getting impacted by the COVID. But the low-end hotel brands were getting impacted by the COVID as well as from the high-end and the mid-range hotels. So this was one thing that we came across. And the second one was that no hotel brand will tell on their own that they fired a few number of employees. So like from this interview, we came to know that there were a few hotel brands that that decided that the overall the employee batch will take a 50% cut. And there were a few hotel brands that decided that 50% employees won't take any cut and 50% employees will directly be fired. So these two points were some different things we came across from the interview that we didn't see in any case studies.
Okay, thanks. By the way, I loved your graphics of your presentations, the animations and terrific.
Thank you, sir.
This one more thing I also wanted to point out was in this hotel, what are the questions that you pose when you're interviewing somebody as an architect and as a researcher for your architectural research? What are the kind of questions you should pose to your manager, etc., whom you're interviewing? So one thing could have been that why don't people go to hotels, or why would I not be comfortable even to go to a hotel today? Even after pandemic, let's say after 3 years. So what are the reasons? Is it the air quality? Is it the kind of finishes? Does it imbibe confidence of health? So these are the questions you must ask. And you know, it will help you redefine standards of what are understood as hotel standards. That is what needs to be, you know, this research and post-pandemic, that is what the main question is, as architects and as designers of these spaces, are those standards correct? Or are we just taking them as standards and following them? So in the sense, do all five-star hotels have to have windows which don't open? And do they have to have centralized air conditioning? Because these are also, they're not just luxury items, they also have health issues attached to them. Or do they have to have buffet dinner, that somebody said we have stopped buffet and started serving in another way? So, you know, surveys, the kind of finishes, the kind of choices we make to make the space are directly connected to the health and to our wanting to be there. So please think it through, and you'll find that some of the basics can be, you can ask questions on those basics, and then nobody will lose their job, you know. Or at least what I'm saying is that the issue is not about, it's a fear of going to a place and getting infected. So what is that fear in space making? I think a lot has to do with finishes, the planning. The planning is very robust in hotels and all of that, you know, that is divided into wings. You can separate out, you can have social distancing, you can have less occupancy, all that is fine. Maybe you'll find solutions in that aspect. There are also solutions to be found in terms of how it is made. So please look at the physical space, look at the details. Have you traveled in by train or airlines post-pandemic? You'll see there are sort of measures they take to make it happen. The train will have stopped serving you food. It stopped serving you. It stopped giving you linen. So if you think of it, a basic dharamshala is also a hotel of some kind. And that ensures a certain, or gives you certain confidence of health and, you know, it's clean. It's neat and clean. Maybe you're more confident living in that than a five-star hotel. So think about those things, and then you can pose the right questions.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Maybe I just want to put in one sentence here. See, the comparison between the hotel and hospital was made, but a hospital is a lifeline situation where there are matters of life and death. While here, you know, you might just catch an infection or you may not. But there you may save a life or you may not, with a few seconds of intervention here or there. That is the very important difference. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable feedback. I would now like to hand over the stage to Ayushi to introduce the next group.
Thank you, Joanne. The last team has given us an insight into how hotels have been hit by the pandemic. The effect of the pandemic has transcended from public spaces to entire cities. However, cities have also been affected by the deteriorating environment as well. We now move on to our second theme for the seminar 2021, climate change, and open session 4, cities. Smart cities are becoming the ideal solution for urban settlements to address the issues and challenges of the future. India also adopted various missions and agendas to be a part of the sustainable journey. The Smart Cities mission, adopted in light of this development, is one of the largest missions concerning urban development and has been ongoing for the past 6 years in the country. To understand more about this mission towards sustainability, let us see the next group with their topic, Smart Cities Mission, Promises and Performance.
Thank you, Ayushi, and greetings to everyone. My name is Pratyush Anand. And with me, I have Aman Raj, Arithro Day, Rana Dakshil, Sumit Kumar, and Vithika Seth as my co-authors, and Professor Prabhjot Singh Sugga as our guide. We will start with a short brief about sustainability and smart city mission, which will form the backdrop of our method of research, finally leading to the results and recommendations. I would like to invite Aman to take this forward.
Thank you, Pratyush. Cities have been long hubs of business, culture, and invention. Approximately 3.5 million people live in cities today, and approximately 5 billion people will live in cities by 2030. Nearly 90% of them are in cities in Asia and Africa. Cities are at the forefront of climate action as never before. Cities, being a major contributor of climate change, holds the maximum potential to mitigate it, rightly said. So I'll briefly introduce about the history of sustainability. In 1983, UN created Brundtland Commission, which released a mandate for the world for attaining sustainability. The iconic contribution of this commission was the publication named Our Common Future, which coined and popularized the term sustainable development, which goes as follows. Development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generation to meet their own needs. In September 2015, a blueprint was signed and adopted by 193 countries to achieve a better and sustainable future. It set 17 goals and 169 targets covering three aspects, namely social, economic, and environment. This was called the Sustainable Development Goals and paved the way for further development and policy formation on sustainability on international fronts. SDG 11 is about sustainable cities and communities. It has 10 targets to be achieved that is being measured with 15 indicators. Countries across the globe committed to creating a new international climate agreement in Paris in December 2015, famously known as the Paris Agreement. India is one of the few countries to act on the Paris Agreement. It has an umbrella organization known as National Action Plan for Climate Change, NAPCC. Working on these lines, aligning to one of the 8 objectives of the NAPCC, the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, known as MAHUA, formulated the Smart Cities Mission in 2015. Now, I would like to invite Sumit to give some insights on smart cities.
Thank you, Aman. Despite of many discussions, there is no agreed definition of a smart city. As an aftermath of World War II, there was a rapid increase in technology and a booming market of a smart product emerged. Hence, the concept of a smart city was introduced to achieve economical, social, and urban development. In general, the knowledge, innovation, and economy are the main drivers of the smart city discourse. Nearly 31% of India's current population live in urban areas and contribute 63% of India's GDP. By 2030, urban areas are predicted to house 40% of India's population and contribute 75% of country's GDP. To meet this ever-increasing demand, extensive physical, institutional, social, and economic infrastructure development is required. So all of these factors result in an ethical cycle of growth and development. Smart city development is a step in that direction. At present, India's Smart City Mission is one of the largest ongoing projects, which is catering to sustainable development. The government of India defines the objective of smart city to promote city that provide infrastructural facility and a decent quality of life for their residents. It also aims for clean and sustainable environment, including the use of a smart solution. Now I would like to invite my colleague Aritro to take forward our presentation.
Thank you, Sumit. I will now take forward. So our research focuses on the following questions based on our background study. How aware are the citizens about the mission? Do citizens see any progress on a neighborhood level? What are the gaps between proposal and the performance of the Smart City Mission on selected cities? By the background study on sustainability and smart cities, we understood its role in mitigating climate change. Then we analyzed the Smart City Mission, its aim, work methodology, and the overall intent of the program. Moving further, we studied the assessment formulated by the government to assess the smart cities' climate performance. By this study, the promises of the mission were known. A survey was further conducted to map the gap between the policies and on-ground realities for the selected case studies. Smart City Mission India is an ambitious urban development program launched in 2015. According to the Government of India, people are the core of the city, and a smart city should serve for its people. They define smart city as the city which works for its people. When formulating the Smart City Mission, Government of India defined three pillars impacting three spheres, namely people, economy, and environment. The pillars are stated as livability, economic ability, and sustainability. As per the definition, Livability enhances aspects of social well-being of a city, enabling citizens to live a decent life. Economic ability ensures that the city is a good place to do business and provide access to a diversity of jobs. And sustainability maintains the balance between natural and built environment in the city. In order to progress further in the three pillars, 24 tangible parameters were formulated by the government, which were common to all the smart cities. We have segregated them in those three pillars by livability, sustainable economic ability, and sustainability. The smart cities were assessed on these 24 parameters by self-assessment. The cities had to identify themselves in one of the four scenarios defined in the smart city guidelines. The four scenarios are discussed in the guidelines are scenario one, called the base, scenario two and three, called the intermediate, and scenario four, the advanced. I would like to invite Pratyush to explain Smart City Mission Assessment Framework in detail.
Thank you, Aritro. The Climate Smart City Assessment Framework is a tool by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs to assess the climate initiative of smart cities. The framework had five sectors with 30 indicators with equal weightage. CSCAF was launched in 2018 to map the progress on the environmental pillar of the mission. It seeks to address both the mitigation and adaptation sides of the equation and to develop the emphasis of different sectors of economy across both the sectors in the Indian urban setting. The second edition of CSCAF in 2019 updated the indicators to 28 with new weighted system as points for assessment seen on the screen. Overlapping the smart city mission features and CSCAF sectors, we found these correlations where 11 of 24 features matches to the indicators of CSCAF. The implemented programs under these features can directly be assessed through CSCAF. Due to limitations of time, we selected Bareilly, Bengaluru, Ranchi, and Vadodara, only 4 of the 100 smart cities as our primary case study. These were preferred based on availability of data and the researchers' places, which would be easy to access if needed. Adding to that, all cities are in different climate zones and hold different ranks according to CSCAF. We selected mobility and air quality as study sectors because transport is the fastest growing source of carbon emission in our country. Also, the aspect in these parameters are closely related to citizens, which would help us to get their opinions with ease. However, it is the only sector among the five which can be assessed by the common public directly through surveys. To map the performance, a primary citizen survey was conducted through online mode. I would like to invite Pithika to explain about survey and the method to map the inferences.
Thank you, Pratyush. The survey was conducted in two parts. The first part contains general questions, which were common to all the four smart cities. It included at least one question from each of the five indicators in the sector as seen on the screen. The second part of the survey contains city-specific questions which were formulated based on the smart city mission proposals under this sector. A set of around 100 citizens were surveyed from each city. This set included people of different age groups and different professions. Majority of the respondents were in the age gap of 20 to 30 years. To conclude the study, the results are divided into two parts. The first part has the results according to CSCAF, which is available under the NIUA program called Climate Center for Cities, CQ. As the CSCAF was launched in 2018, we calculated the CQ score on 2016, which was the beginning of the mission, on the basis of previous year's data. For the 2019 data, the score was added using the published score. The third column provides us if the SCM proposal provided initiatives for the given indicator. A qualitative conclusion was derived on the progress by the comparison of the 2016-2019 scores and if the SCM proposal provided initiators for the same in the final column. On the basis of the last two columns, four statements can be concluded. To connect the results, we formed this matrix to distinguish four possible cases. If the proposal stated initiatives and the CFCF score also say that it is in progress, then we code them as A. If the initiative was proposed but does not see any significant progress, then B. If the proposal had no initiatives and the situation remains same, it's C. And if there is progress without any initiative, the code is D. The inferences are then mapped with the survey inferences to get a correlation that is either a positive or a negative correlation. The survey was considered as the on-ground reality, and hence positive correlation would mean that there is progression, while negative will mean that the progress is low or non-existent. I would now ask Dakshil to explain the results and inferences of a survey for the cities.
Thank you, Vithika, for explaining the methods to assess the result. I would explain the detailed results only for Vadodara due to limited time. The detailed results for all the cities are provided in the paper. In Vadodara, for the indicator clean technology shared vehicles, 97% of Vadodara citizens are aware about their shared vehicles running on green fuel, that is CNG or LPG. For 52% of surveyed people, public transport is accessible within 1 kilometer of their place, and 86% of citizens say that it is affordable for the majority of public. For the air pollution indicator, around 68% of citizens say that the city has average air quality, leaning on the better side with 15% rating 4 out of 5. For the clean air action plan indicator, we ask the citizens about government efforts to overcome air pollution. 68% of people feel that the efforts were below average. Under walkability head, the city was supposed to improve the pedestrian facilities and set up bicycle sharing facilities, but the implementation was either unknown or not done according to the majority of citizens. For the city, indicator 1 contains positive correlation, but it was achieved as the city had already started converting its auto rickshaws and buses to CNG since 2004. The air quality is already under control as per the survey. The non-motorized transport coverage was one of the biggest input in the proposal, but the city was not able to deliver. Also, many projects have not yet started. All in all, the city is performing in terms of progress, but not able to focus on all at once. For Bengaluru, the focus was to make the city connected and healthy by improving pedestrian facilities and promoting non-motorized transport. Bengaluru Smart City proposal has many projects such as increase in parking and an extensive pedestrian network. But for the majority of citizens, the progress toward this work was minimal and slow. The public transport, however, has proved its point to the public and working well in terms of affordability. The shared vehicles are on its way to being converted to use green fuels. The Ranchi government wanted to solve the issue of traffic congestion in the city and to create a smooth flow of traffic on major arterial roads. They intended on improving the infrastructure for non-motorized vehicles by creating paths for pedestrians and cyclists. According to the citizens, it is poor. Even though the city rates itself well in coverage of non-motorized transport roads, the citizens do not feel it being implemented. Some of the other projects under the mission are still under tendering process and have not yet fully implemented. In Bareilly, the main focus was on social aspects. The air quality of city is already good as per the citizens. For Bareilly, shared vehicles are auto rickshaws are considered as public transport as there is no intra-city bus service available. Still, it has been quite affordable to the citizens. However, the pedestrian infrastructure is poor and the city was not able to deliver the proposed. The slow pace of development for all the cities has been hampered by pandemic and lockdown, which forced new projects to come to a halt. Now, I would hand over again to Vithika to conclude our result.
Thank you, Dakshil, for the results. On the basis of this summary, we can conclude that India knows its future trajectory in different sectors to attain environmental sustainability. The government has formed different organizations and launched missions, but the survey results indicate the other side of the story. The studied cities were not able to focus on all the sectors at the same time, even with all the right institutions already formed. The citizens don't see much progress in terms of its implementation. The pace of the progress is very slow. Many of the projects are in the tender stage even after 6 years since the project was initiated. Hence, people are not even aware of such projects. Based on the conclusions and the current picture of the Smart City mission, these are the few recommendations in the field our research feels can help bridge the gap between theory and practice. Timely regulation of citizen participation would help get a reality check and help document the process systematically. They can run awareness programs to improve citizen participation. Inclusion of private partners and stakeholders can be considered. This will improve the quality and accountability of projects. Organizing various competitions and learning from the successful projects, both on a national and international level, can help get new and innovative ideas. Time management still remains a big hurdle in India's path to sustainability, and measures should be taken to escalate the progress. Increasing the speed would increase the scope of opportunities for the city planners, urban designers, architects, and all the stakeholders involved. Thank you. This brings to the end of our presentation.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to post their questions in the chat box or the Q&A forum.
I think it was a very well put together study. Your flow of arguments make a lot of sense. There is conclusions, recommendations, which are apt. Quite impressed with the sample size for your surveys, which is, like you said, 100 per city. So you actually surveyed 400
people. Yes, sir.
Which is incredible, I mean, in the short duration of time. So I apart from the fact that, you know, what are the takeaways for you as a student from this, apart from the wonderful exercise of having done the research yourself and knowing the steps to doing proper research, how are you going to take this forward is something that I'll be curious to know as students of architecture, or but otherwise I don't have too many comments at this stage. Thank you very much.
I just have a suggestion that, you know, if you could have some the cities that you have researched or your case studies, if you had some visuals of those areas, then it kind of completes the picture and add, you know, I mean, where is this? Yeah, have you collected all this data from some secondary source, or where is it from?
So the surveys were all primary surveys. And since we could not go out, we shared the surveys through Google Form to our relatives and friends and asked them to circulate, and slowly it reached to a number where we were satisfied. And the data that we had collected from the websites of government and various other institutions, those were open data for public to view.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir, we visited some places where, like, it was given in the proposal, but was not implemented. Like in Ranchi, there was a whole new greenfield project which was going to come up, but it is not even had started. Just the roads have been made. So yeah, Pratyush can elaborate on that further.
Yes, sir. So if I may take a minute and explain a little. So in Ranchi, the development was supposed to be taking part in two parts. The one was the Pan City development, which included improving the transport and the traffic management. And the other was an area-based development where the government envisaged a new town of around 5 kilometers square 5 kilometer. And they wanted to create all the things that they could not change in the old city. So they had wide roads with footpaths and underground sewage, well-planned cities, well-planned places. So, but institutions and places were not, they haven't come up yet. And I visited all these sites as mentioned in the proposal, and almost none of them had come up yet.
You had a parameter index D, which says that there is no intention or there is no planning, but the projects have come up. And you put that.
So for that parameter, the smart city mission is a whole different thing for the other mission, other missions or other proposals. So the cities are doing progress in the fields where the cities are anyway progressing through their ongoing projects, so they don't come under the smart city mission, but the progress is ongoing, and the index deep refer to this part.
But there was nothing that you found in the four cities which corresponded to this.
It does in Vadodara, I guess it was there.
What was that?
So Aman, can you move to Vadodara slide?
Yeah.
Yes. So it was for air pollution and clean air action plan. So it means for this the quality is not changing in Vadodara. The air quality is not changed much in the previous 5 years. It has not deteriorated or the quality has not increased, but there was no mention of any initiatives to do such. That's why the citizens are happy, and so we have put a DO.
Answer for your previous question, I think if we had more time, we would have done this survey, this research for more number of cities. And since we were limited to only four cities, we could not get an overall picture of what is happening at a national level. So if we could have done it for more cities, and also if we could have covered more topic apart from mobility and transport. So since this was the mobility and transport was the one where we could talk to the citizens and find out the other sectors, we needed to go to government offices and we needed to find out data. So we could have done that, and then we could have analyzed it. Cities are also not only just responsible, they are also most vulnerable to climate change, and hence these results, our results should help the designers and planners and architects of future cities to include resilience to climate change and better sustainable development in their design ideas.
Adding to that, like if you have done the survey, if you would have got time and done the survey for like say the city who is not doing good according to CSCAF, and like some city like Indore, which is doing very well in the proposal. So we can compare and like we can elaborate some features which can be implemented in other cities as well. We can suggest some strategies which they have adopted and can be implemented across the nation. That is one thing, like we can do it after the for the further studies.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Prithyush, you just mentioned that you did some kind of a site survey where you tried to see what all projects were there, maybe in the proposal, but whether they have been implemented. So what kind of site visits you had done? Which city?
For Ranchi, since I live in Ranchi, so I took the proposal of Ranchi Smart City and I analyzed it, and I came across a map where they had proposed the development of a new 5 kilometer sector, which was earlier a green field. So there they had proposed various institutions such as schools, hospitals, hotels, and LRT, the monorail, and a few other institutions. So when I visited the site, I saw that most of the site was still greenfield, and the only development that had taken place was the roads. The roads were constructed. So I came back and then I looked up on the website and I found out that most of the buildings in that area were still under tender stage. So the government had listed them up for tendering, but they have not yet been, the construction has not yet started. It's still in the tendering stage and different construction companies are bidding for it.
Okay. So why don't you mention the time period during which you did all these site visits and include those photographs also to make it more credible what you have done in terms of theory and practice, the gaps that you have managed to find. So put those photographs so it will be more credible. Put it in your maybe your paper. I don't think so. We have included that in the presentation right now.
No, ma'am. We have not included that. Sure, ma'am. We'll take this suggestion.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Prabhjit, you're not audible.
No, no, I'm good. I'm thanks. I think thank you for the time and good luck to the.
Thanks.
I think this was a fantastic presentation. Congratulations. And I'd like to connect with you once again to see how to operationalize one of the suggestions given by the jury members, that what's next. Because if tendering is the main issue, there is a lot of work that CPWD has done to facilitate this. But I think that can happen in the winter vacations after your design and construction submissions. So in the meantime, see if you can get this published and send it as an academic paper to the National Institute of Urban Affairs and for their information, because the third round of assessment is going to start soon and they can take your views into consideration also. Well done.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Congratulations, team. There's a query for you in the chat box. What do you feel is the role of smart citizens in helping smart cities achieve their goals?
So what we think, or what, let me say what I think about this, is smart citizens should be aware of what is happening in their neighborhood, in their surrounding, what are the proposals, because if they don't know, they can't question them. And if once they question, they come together and question them, it will happen. It has to happen. So according to me, the smart citizens would mean this definition, that a citizen is a citizen who is aware of his surroundings, neighborhood, and the governance that is happening.
Anybody else from the team would like to share their comments on this?
Also, the citizens are the main key aspects of the smart city, and a city can't be built can't be built smart unless the citizens do not participate in the transformation. So I know from my side, the role of citizen in building smart city is very important.
Why I brought this out was for the simple reason that smart city planning is only one hand of the clap. There cannot be any city without the citizens. Let's take a small example of waste management. We all are aware there is a biodegradable and there's non-degradable systems put in place. Okay, but the initiative starts right from our kitchens. Now, if citizens do not choose, or how much they choose to plug into the schemes or the policies that have been put in, the systems that have been put in, any system cannot have its full impact. Do you agree to that standpoint? Incidentally, the whole narrative about the smart cities is being looked at from a very objective standpoint. कि कहीं कोई कुछ कर रहा है और हमें सिर्फ वहां पे रहना है विदाउट रियली अंडरस्टैंडिंग दैट द मैनर इन विच वी लिव एंड वी मेक आवर चॉइसेस एंड प्लग इट इनटू दोज सिस्टम्स आई मीन द चॉइस ऑफ हैविंग माय ओन कार और चूजिंग अ पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट इज अ चॉइस दैट आई मेक टू मेक द स्मार्ट सिटी प्रोविजन सक्सेसफुल एंड इफ somewhere, not just questioning the smart cities system, but becoming a part of it
that awareness seems to be, in hindsight, it seems to be almost invisible. It seems it is being done for the citizens, but citizens just need to live the way they are living anyways.
People are unaware. People are unaware, and that's the main reason development
there
is not.
There is a certain responsibility that comes on us to make the smart city perform to its fullest. And that narrative in all smart city dialogues, as well as documentation that I have come across, is missing completely. And that is where I felt like asking you your standpoint, since you have seen it from one perspective, how you felt about it. Because I very strongly feel that, you know, there cannot be a one-hand clap. And so far, perhaps if there is a partial success of smart cities, it is due to the fact that other hand is just not there. I don't know how you feel about it. I thought I'll just share this because you have done a pretty good effort in analyzing one hand of the clap. Let's bring the other hand also there. Thank you.
Also, sir, the mindset of the people nowadays is that they are just limited to the four walls in which they reside. They just feel that as home. They have to see that all around them is a home. Yes. They cannot just throw the dust out of their home to the road.
Yes.
That's not acceptable, because anyways they will be coming from that road itself to their house. So it won't look nice. So for, yeah, so community participation is, I think, very important. And to feel that community is our home.
The execution of any smartness comes from smart people. No object, no city, no planning, no building can be green or smart in itself without the users being smart. And unfortunately, smartness is being equated with technological savviness only. And somewhere, this aspect that Aman, you just mentioned, that, you know, that sense of belongingness extends beyond my four walls, is a very important aspect that now needs to maybe smartcity.v2 that needs to be including this aspect of belongingness. Otherwise, all these missions are just on they are just frameworks, but it's the people who operate within those frameworks that bring in the real efficacy. Now,
on the other hand, I think
thank you for taking that forward.
Our people are over smart. दिवाली में पटाखे बैन कर रखे हैं, पता नहीं कहां कहां से ढूंढ ढूंढ के लाके फोड़ रहे हैं यहां पे.
Can you hear me?
In fact, we have to start from ourselves. How many of us segregate our waste, for instance? We have to take it ourselves and do it from our start with ourselves. There's no doubt about that. There is no point, you know, we can't be professionals advising people and doing nothing about it in our own homes.
One point I realized that there were almost 1500 cars, new cars coming onto, or maybe more, per day on daily roads. And when I understood that data, the first thing that came to my mind was there cannot be any amount of planning, any kind of framework that can be put. As long till we do not take care of this aspect, incidentally, falls within the purview of my free choice. You know, you cannot stop people from buying cars. So there can be many more instances, right, from waste segregation to the choices that we make that has an impact on the manner our smart cities or any cities. In fact, if we start becoming smart, our cities by default will become half smart anyways. Sorry, Prabhjot, please carry on.
No, I just want to add, you're right, like most of the programs, we have a problem, you know, with the minimal, you can say, response from the citizens, but that is also a function of the strong civil society that I think has been inherently lacking for the long time in our, you know, our country. And that is also reflected on the fact that, you know, maybe the programs are designed such that, you know, the participation is reduced to minimal in most of the cases. I've come across lots of, you know, these programs where, you know, they, in the name of the participation, you know, they have like very minimal survey from the people's side, and that's the end of the story. I think it is a purely a function of how strong your, or how vibrant your society is. Then all these factors of, you know, making choices, or rather making collective choices, you know, whether to have a public transport, or whether to have, you know, or whether to not have it, or whether to, you know, fight for your, you know, resources, or, you know, whether to stop a particular unwanted development in your area. You know, those kind of things, I think, probably will only come if you're organized in a certain way, which I think is lacking in, I don't see that happening in most of the part of the country.
I'll give you a very good example in this case. Now, a smart system in place, let's say BSES sends me a bill, and on that bill it shows me that congratulations, this month you were amongst the top 25% of the people who use their electricity economically. Now what has happened is everything is the same, but as a user I have been empowered, I have been informed first that okay, when you use this much watts, then out of the entire locality you are staying in, the maximum 10 people who are using this, you fall in the top 30% efficient. Nobody is stopping me. They are not guiding me to reduce it. But just by sharing a data information in a particular manner, I suddenly am aware that I can also make a difference just by using lesser electricity or more effectively. These are small ways in which policy starts reaching out to people without sounding too dictatorial. But right now, if you go and ask anybody staying in Bhubaneswar is supposed to be a smart city, that, you know, how can you contribute? They would not really have a direct clue. So can there be a system by which a communication be in place, indirect, not dictatorial, but by more as a guideline, you know, that, you know, from waste to traffic to commute to electricity, what are the ideal things that everybody can do? And I'm sure that out of 100, maybe 4 or 5 people will definitely want to do it onerously out of awareness. But overall, it was a good start to have this discussion. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir and ma'am. I now request Joanne to take the seminar forward and introduce us to the next topic.
Thank you, Aishi. Coming up next is the next topic, Moving the Masses, Making Way for Buses on Indian Roads. Most cities in the developing world today are dealing with rapid growth in urban travel demand, particularly in regard to personal motorized modes of travel. This in turn has increased congestion, leading to deterioration in air quality, which has negative implications for climate change. Governments are looking at ways to improve public transport. The objective of this is to reduce personalized vehicle travel by offering more travel alternatives through improved public transport. We would now like to invite the group to discuss the aspects of one such public transport system.
Thank you, Joanne. A very good afternoon to the esteemed members of the jury, faculty, viewers, and our fellow colleagues. I, Joseph Matthew, would be joined by my colleagues Pooja Muralidharan, Priyanshu Pardi, Soumya Gupta, Shubhdeep Sarkar, and Supreme Narkun in presenting our research to you today. The transportation industry currently accounts for nearly 1/4 of worldwide energy-related greenhouse gas emissions and could more than triple by 2050 if aggressive mitigation measures are not taken. It is imperative to decarbonize and amend the transport sector to curb the impact of climate change globally. In a country like ours, which is experiencing tremendous economic growth, there is a dire need to shift from the unplanned urban sprawl to an inclusive transit-oriented development. The concept of transit-oriented development commits to the integration of urban spaces that bring public spaces, buildings, activities, and people with ease of accessibility. This prompts the need for a multimodal transit system to ensure inclusive access to all citywide opportunities and resources. One of the most successful examples of a city with a successfully planned transit is that of Curitiba in Brazil. Curitiba recognized the need to plan its urban growth along transport corridors very early on. The city's then mayor, Jaime Lerner, an architect and urban planner, saw an opportunity in the one form of transport that many consider a lost cause, the bus. He introduced the concept of giving buses a dedicated right of way so it could have as many functional advantages as a light rail. The strength of the system lies within the idea that public transport is key to urban development. Now I invite Pooja to continue the discussion.
Thank you, Joseph. A typical BRTS provides dedicated lanes with busways and stations usually aligned to the middle of the road, making it a far more dependable and faster than ordinary bus services. This feature makes it akin to a light rail or a metro system on the road. This system requires funding that is approximately 1/10 to 1/20 the cost of the metro and is 7 times cheaper than the light rail because it requires a comparatively lesser amount of infrastructure to develop. Bus rapid transit with the correct implementation can eliminate the delays that plague the ordinary bus services, such as getting caught in traffic, unreliable schedules, and long waiting periods. It also provides a safer transport environment for drivers, pedestrians, and cyclists alike. Curitiba's innovative city planning paved the way for many cities to start incorporating this unique ideal of participatory city planning that emphasized public education, discussion, and agreement, with many cities following suit, such as Transmilenio Bus Rapid Transit in Bogota, Janmark BRT in Ahmedabad, Transjakarta in Jakarta, Mexico City Metrobus. In this research, we try to understand how a BRT system can supplement the existing transportation sector and how it can aid in urban development. We also explore the concept of social equity on the roads and how BRT can help. We attempt to understand this by undertaking a thorough case study of the Janmark BRT in Ahmedabad and Rainbow BRT of Pune. This study is limited to reviewing public transit behavior pre-pandemic, as we're still undergoing the effects of pandemic, and there does not exist enough data yet to study the aspect in complete detail. We established a research methodology that involved interviewing riders and non-riders about their daily experience with the BRT. We further corroborated this with interviews we conducted of planning professionals from the same field. We also drafted out maps of projected development to understand the intent and outcome behind planning the corridors. And compiling all our findings, we listed out our inferences and learnings on how to make these systems work better for the Indian context. The parameters which were determined essential for the selection of the case studies were existing transportation infrastructure of the city, plans of integration with public transportation network, existing and planned, political and public support, and the type of system, to draw a comparison between closed systems like that of Ahmedabad and open systems of that like that in Pune. Timing of implementation with respect of urban development stage, and above all, our personal experience with the system chosen. A comparative case study of both cities under the heading of BRT working, service planning, infrastructure, station detailing, communications, operations, governance and policies, and cost effectiveness was done. This helped us understand a full context of the system we were about to survey. Now I invite Supreme to continue the discussion on our case studies.
Thank you, Pooja. In 2010, Forbes magazine rated Ahmedabad as one of the fastest growing cities in the world. It is located on the strategic Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor that creates a large potential for investment, industrialization, and development. In 2000, its only existing public transport network, the AMTS bus network, started seeing a decline among its users due to rise in income of the residents and increase in private vehicle ownership. This led the city authorities to explore the methods to reverse declining modal share of public transport. In 2005, the BRT was introduced to provide an effective and reliable public transit system. The smart city proposal of Ahmedabad was based on the principle of compact development and inclusiveness. It focused on retrofitting the existing physical infrastructure for a compact and densified transit-oriented development and in-situ redevelopment of one of the largest slums in the city. After understanding the intent and the reasons of the city's development of its BRT system, we mapped out the planning and the implementation of the system in the city. The development of BRT was planned in three phases. The initial phase where the BRT was connected on the either parts of the river, and the second phase where it connected the two sites, forming the closed BRT network. The third phase is still under development. Next, we looked at the number of buses per hour through the various corridors in the various parts of the city and found the highest usage in the older and higher density regions of the city. Further, the relation between the bus usage and the population density was mapped, and it was noted that the already developed city would plan the main BRT corridors through their higher density regions of the city. The planning relies on the land use patterns, that is the here, that is the residential areas which is lying on the periphery and the industrial regions on the border of the cities on one side of the river. The closed network system depends on a feeder network to increase its users. So it is important to design a system with an effective catchment area within the walking radius. Here from these traffic congestion maps, we also observe how few of the highly congested roads have a BRT around them and not exactly through them. In public transportation network maps, the orange line represents the AMTS network, which is the current feeder network to the operating BRT system, and how it's connected to how it connects to the major transportation hubs. Furthermore, it is important to have an idea of the user group to whom the BRT system is mainly meant to cater. So we try to zone the population density of the city according to the various economic sections. One of the goals of the smart city development of the, was to use the BRT to create a commercial hub through the slums and economically weaker section in the city. Next, we try to analyze and draw conclusions with the help of the expert about the effects of the BRT towards the city. Several clusters of land under the industrial zone are within close vicinity to the residential areas within the city's administrative boundary. This urban settlement pattern and workplace location has developed a travel pattern with regular trips from both directions from the periphery to the city center. This has also led to redevelopment along the corridors with a high built-up space ratio, and its effect can be vividly seen in the urban skyline with some structure going up to G+5. The closed BRT network relies significantly on a feeder network to increase its users. There is an inner loop which spreads out in a radial manner without a strong feeder network. The BRT does not reach the residential areas lying in the suburbs of the city where the majority of the lower income and the middle income group reside, which could be visualized through the population maps seen before. We also wanted to show the effects of the BRT, effect that the BRT corridor have towards the urban growth pattern. So we try to see the comparison between the 2009 map of the Ahmedabad with 2020. We observe significant growth in the regions marked in the white dotted lines, which are along the BRT corridors or at the end nodes of it. We further notice less significant growth towards the south part of the city, where there isn't much connectivity through the BRT corridors. Now, I would like to invite Pranchu to continue this discussion.
Thank you, Supreme. Pune is a city driven by growing technology sector and a thriving student population, and can be considered as a city portraying rapid urbanization. The key economic driver of the city has so far been the automobile industry located in the industrial zones. Pimpri-Chinchwad and Pune city are inextricably linked with each other, with a substantial number of workers traveling from Pune to Pimpri every day, because of which clear corridors of origins and destinations can be demarcated within the city. However, the public transportation system in Pimpri-Chinchwad has not been able to provide the best services to its citizens. This has led to a steep increase in private ownership of vehicles, especially motorized two-wheelers. The BRT being planned at a developing start of the city was meant to serve as a guiding factor and contribute to the city's TOD, and also bring order and development to its roads by widening of existing roads with wherever required to ensure hierarchy and continuity, linking new roads to complete missing networks and establishing desirable patterns, and aligning new roads to the periphery to serve future development and carry regional traffic. The open BRT network in Pimpri forms a grid of intersecting corridors and facilitates alternative routes to capture more users. Future plans of integrating dedicated right-of-ways in Pune and Pimpri are visible here. The BRT corridor falls under the region of high population density when considered to the population density of Pimpri-Chinchwad. After being an open network, the majority of BRT users are the ones who walk to the bus stops. This makes it necessary to incorporate an effective catchment area. As Pimpri lacks in having a good network with a proper network with its secondary roads, the BRT is aligned with the major highways which pass through the city. This map represents how the feeder networks are connected to major roads of the BRT corridors. This further shows the major national highways which connect Pune and Mumbai running through the Pimpri-Chinchwad core. The Comprehensive Mobility Plan of 2008 considered the BRT as a medium to create mixed land use patterns and aid development of the residential zones. The map here shows the urban growth projection, which focuses on the development of the new IT sectors, the integration of Pimpri-Chinchwad, and the upcoming international airport in Sakhar. We have mapped out the current growth scenario of Pimpri-Chinchwad with the projected plans to understand how the BRT network can assist TOD and planned in the city development. The BRT corridors continue to serve the low-income groups due to their convenience and affordability. On the other hand, the developing IT sector has increasingly been providing job opportunities for the higher-income groups. Improving the service can thus help provide in the scope of target users to high-income groups. An open system reduces reliance of public on feeder networks, therefore improving the catchment area. The regions circled out here are the IT parks, one being the Hinjewadi IT park and the second being the Tadaude IT park. The arrows represent the projected growth direction as per the comprehensive mobility plan by Pune and Pimpri-Chinchwad Municipal Corporation. Now I invite Soumya to continue the discussion.
Thank you, Priyanshu. Surveys of three types of daily commuters were conducted via on-ground interviews and online medium. The first two groups who were interviewed included the BRT users and non-users. The third group of people surveyed were the public transit users residing in a city without BRT facilities. The survey initially focused on understanding to whom does the system cater and further analyze how it benefits them. In order to understand what was the profile of the average user, we sought out to establish their gender, age group, income group, and purpose of use. Throughout our surveys, we identified certain profiles of users like daily wage workers and young women on their way to work, young adults on their way to school/tuition, etc. A majority of corridors along which BRT routes were established could create easier access to jobs and economic opportunities. In Pune, the routes connected to the industrial belt and hence why we see a higher ridership among lower income group industrial workers. In Ahmedabad, the BRT had seen a wider support from political leadership, and as we noted, Prime Minister Narendra Modi himself endorsed the use of BRT. This is one of the reasons why there has been a more mixed profile of user groups in the city. The effects of these points can also be seen here, as transit users can be defined as two types as per studies, that is, choice riders and captive riders. One of the most corrosive ideas regarding bus transit is that most people who ride it have no alternative and will continue using it no matter how bad the service gets, and that therefore there is no need to upgrade the existing system. However, as we surveyed our users, we came to realize that 80% of users in Ahmedabad and 62% in Pune had an alternative choice of transport but chose to keep using the service because of the quality and convenience of BRT. Based on the surveys and interviews that we conducted for the study, we drew the conclusion that the bus riders want a well-connected service network where the riders can easily walk to and from their final destinations. A frequent and a fast service so that they don't have to wait for the bus or plan their day according to the schedule. The service must also be reliable, and safety and comfort is also one of the main requirements. To further drive home the importance of walkability to and from the stations, we asked the users their preferred mode of transport, and the majority of users prefer to walk. Adding another dimension to this is how the feeder network also adds another layer of accessibility. Pune, being an open system, sees a higher modal share with the feeder buses. Then we sought to understand in what aspects the system fails to provide the users of their basic needs. In a city like India, growing population and aging and inefficient systems have always been a problem. There is also a problem of competing systems, which often lead to dismantling of certain corridors, which adds to further inefficiency. As we saw, the development of metro corridors led to the dismantling of Pune BRT, some of the Pune BRT corridors. Further, India is yet to see a completely successful example of BRT, which can serve as an aspirational model for other cities to follow. To some extent, Ahmedabad has succeeded in being a good example, as it has won a lot of international recognition for the quality and convenience it provides. In addition to that, the problems of pickpocketing, fare collection and payment, fewer seats and social apathy were other problems mentioned by some of the users. Despite that, the majority of users were content with the service provided. In addition to the case study of Ahmedabad and Pune, we also tried to understand the failure of Delhi BRT. This was essential, as public perception regarding the BRT took a major hit when the Delhi government decided to dismantle its pilot corridors near Molchand after years of negative media depictions and strong resistance from private vehicle owners to the reduction of road space. The BRT has faced several operational issues from its onset. It was marketed as a high-capacity bus corridor rather than a BRT, both of which had two different implications. It was also at a very early stage of its development, and only one of its planned corridors was built. Now I invite Shubhadeep to continue the discussion.
Thank you, Soumya. Now, the key question raised by the Delhi BRT was, are the users of the BRT system its only beneficiaries? That idea has been debunked, since there are several others who benefit from the system, even if they don't use it. For example, people who use cars benefit from reduced congestions on road. People who own property near transit corridors also benefit from increased property values. And employers benefit from having employees with ease access to work. Mass transit also reduces emission, leading to cleaner air for everyone in the higher community. When lanes are reassigned from traffic to well-designed higher capacity road, people adjust their behavior around the system. It connects low-income communities residing on the outskirts to jobs in the city core, as well as minimize commuter travel times to employers. It establishes clear routes of travel, promotes economic growth along its corridor. This, in turn, supports greater democratization of road space. As the Minister of Road and Transport Authority rightly said, wealth does not create roads, rather roads create wealth. Thereby, we need to start recognizing public transit as an investment for the public good. Moving on, a few key takeaways for framing the urban mobility could be: promoting equity on road, prioritizing people over cars should be the motto. Cities and mobility should be planned for together. Stakeholders should be involved at different levels of participation. Additionally, planners should work towards the social integration and seamless connectivity. Shared and efficient use of vehicles, lanes, curbs should be supported. And lastly, transition towards a zero emission future and renewable energy should be planned for. Various measures can be taken at a city level to promote and better design of the BRT network. Reevaluate the need for metros in corridors along which BRT route already exists. Enhance the public transport so as to increase accessibility to jobs, schools, amenities, and community functions. Designing cities to encourage walking and cycling along with safe and energy efficient public transit. Establishing mixed land uses. Engaging the communities through various campaigns and participatory design, improving the feeder network along with main routes. Parking infrastructures for two-wheelers should be introduced. And lastly, employers should be encouraged to give concessions to employees to ride public transit. Transit is personal. It shapes our decisions of where we live and where we work. We might interact with transit daily regardless of whether we use it. All bus riders deserve a transit experience that is safe, welcoming, and intuitive regardless of their age, race, income, or gender. No single transport solution can possibly meet all collective needs. In every case, these systems should easily be integrated into and become a valuable part of the overall mobility system of the city. Therefore, so we leave you with a message. Bus dekho mat, use bhi karo. With this, we end our presentation and we would like to thank and acknowledge everyone who has been essential to our research and thank them for their valuable time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, team, for your presentation. I'd now like to invite the jury to give their comments and feedback, as well as the audience to pose their questions in the box.
So I think it's a very interesting presentation and a research paper that you have made. Congratulations for that. I just had two observations. One is, in both these cities that you have studied, Ahmedabad and Pune, have there been implants in the older part of the city, or they are successful as new as the city being planned around it and this being planned from its inception? And in Delhi, the area that it failed, it was surely an implant, and maybe that would have been a primary reason for its non-acceptance. So that, if you could highlight that also in the paper later, so that, you know, it's clear that what does the success of a system like this depend on? I mean, what success rate is more because when it is planned initially, or other examples of implants also being working well? That is one. And the second is it can't be by itself. It obviously needs further linkages and for its success. So have the Pune and Ahmedabad examples highlighted and focused on that while they were doing the BRT system? Did they also plan for other transport systems as part of their proposal, or was it just left to chance?
Right, thank you. So Supreme, would you like to take up those questions?
Yes, coming to the first question about the integration in the older parts of the city. So here in Ahmedabad, you can, the right side of the map, what you can see just beside the river is the older parts of the city where you can see large lakes there. So there, if you analyze it, so it has the highest number of ridership through them, marked in the dark color. So it turned out to be it was used more in those older parts of the city, and even the development around its corridor was way more in those parts. So this was that was also one of the reasons why we chose these two cities, as Ahmedabad had Ahmedabad had already developed significantly before they implemented BRT, and Pimpri-Chinchwad was about to develop. So the way of looking at these two systems were, Ahmedabad tried to integrate what they had and create an efficient system for transport. Pune tried to develop their city through their networks. So even their open network system concept works with that, where the buses move out of the corridor and provide and improve their last mile connectivity too, like capturing more people. And
adding to that, so Pune and Pimpri were like sister cities. So what was being seen was that, you know, that because of the industrial belt, there were workers moving between and outside every day, and they wanted to develop them so that there were less differences between the boundaries. And so what the BRT corridor was meant to do was to promote more economic growth between the two cities so that the boundaries between them blurred. And definitely a plan which was not a retrofit. It was thought beforehand, before the city developed to its full potential. Whereas in Ahmedabad, the city was developed to a considerable extent after, and after that the system was planned. And because of that, sometimes, so adding to the second question, like the feeder networks in Ahmedabad are not as well developed as what were in Pune, also because it was a closed system. So that was something that was lacking, because of which access and connectivity to other parts of the cities, well, it was a little stunted. But in Pune, it was easier to do that because it was an open system.
Okay, thank you. So I think one of the what I was trying to get at is the secured usership of both of in Pune Chinchwad. You're saying there is an industrial industries come up and there is a lot of people using it. So there's a secured usership. Same with Ahmedabad.
Yeah.
Now, is it that what makes it successful, or is it its urban integration and the way it is planned in physical form? Or which one plays a higher what lies, where does the success lie? The point is, in Delhi, let's say there were many users, but it failed because of, I think, the way it was physically not accepted as an integrated system on the roads it was laid. So these you have studied the maps and the systems, but also in physical form, if you could include some of those studies of what in a sectional format or in the physical photographs of how the design pans out finally as a physical space, that might beyond the bus stand, you know, what happens to the periphery, how does it integrate, how does one cross the street, you know, who picks you up from the station. So if you can kind of expand your study to that, it will complete it for these two cities.
Right. So we did definitely take up pictures of when we were doing the surveys. I think we need to add them to the presentation to make it a complete. We could.
I think Rahul also asked a question about the last mile connectivity and how that impacts the success of the system overall. And I mean, that would also kind of help your study take it to one level further, where we are talking not just of the system, but also the support system around it. I found your study very, very good. It's very thorough. In fact, I got a little bit confused between primary and secondary sources, because I could not tell which was a primary and which was a secondary source. Even the maps that you have drawn, whether you have redrawn them or whether you have drawn them from mathematical data, and the infographics have been generated from mathematical data rather than from previous graphics, is not clear. I'll appreciate if you elaborate on that. Also, the number of surveys that you've conducted, for example, for Pune, you've conducted 90 people and 40 were conducted from Ahmedabad, is what I see. But how were these done? Were they done by, did you reach out on the net, reach out in person?
Yeah, if I can add to. So the maps were actually...
Bunch of questions, so I'll just finish them. And then you can respond them one by one. Your previous topic was decongesting cities, analyzing impact of dedicated right of way for bus transit in Indian cities. Am I right? And now I think it's what's the present topic now?
This was just a title, Moving the Masses. The moving. Research paper is still decongesting cities and
So the question that comes from the topic is, does it decongest? And I think that still remains unanswered, because I have not found an answer to, because the topic of either the title is misleading, because you're not there to analyze decongestion, you're there to analyze the success of a certain mass transit system, right? So whether we change the title a little bit, or you
if you have found evidence of decongestion in these cities, it'll be good to know.
Right, sir. So firstly, I'll answer the questions about the maps. So the maps have been, the networks and everything have been compiled from various sources, but we have redrawn them and we have drawn our inferences. So things like, you know, walking radii has been, have been done on our own. And then we kind of took forward from the land use pattern. So all of this have been derived from various sources and drawn, redrawn by us on one set of, you know, visual kind of maps. And the surveys that were done were actually, surveys were done by, there are two members who reside in these cities, and we actually went to the stations, and from Pune we got 50 responses, and we went to the stations and interviewed the users, because we felt it would be a better outcome if we were to actually explain what was to be expected from them. And the other city in Ahmedabad also, we went to 40, we got 41 responses. The responses are a little bit varied because of the number of days and the like different hours of timings that we went. And we also documented that how many, what were the like the most busiest time that were there. So that was how we did our surveys. And for the non-users, we conducted an online survey where we circulated it online through WhatsApp and other mediums. And we collected like 106 responses from 17 different cities. And this was also from like, including city of Pune and Ahmedabad. Regarding decongesting of roads, I think like the BRT is introduced as a measure to, you know, think beforehand and to reduce what is already exceeding, like what is already going out of hand. So like in Ahmedabad, what was being seen was, you know, there was more reliance on private vehicle and two-wheelers. So in order to curb that is what the BRT was introduced as. And similarly, even in Pune, there were more reliance on a seven-seater, like those paratransit systems. And in order to like more formalize the transit along those lanes, the BRT was introduced. And hence, we see a better outcome of that through the development. It was hard to analyze how, traffic-wise, it would kind of impact, because that kind of survey, I think would though be very nice to get it, but it wasn't available on, or we even tried to contact people who were there in the planning of the system, and even for them it was kind of hard to get a number value based decongestion of how much actually it decongested. But it definitely did through development and progress. So
I would like to add one more thing. So in Pune, they had a major problem of already existing road network system. So there was no hierarchy continuity, and there was major problems with secondary roads and continuity of the road hierarchy. So they took BRT as a way to develop this. So they formed this grid network, which would lie on the major road networks. And this, so the open network would, and the feeder network would eventually develop and create an order and hierarchy in the road network system and eventually develop them. And in order to increase the overall road connectivity and give sense to the major roads by connecting them to the secondary and tertiary roads.
So in you also spoke about the feeder bus system. In Delhi, for example, we had this ring road, the Mudrika services, which would run on the ring roads. And then from there, it's like a wheel and spokes kind of a thing where, radial there would be the ring buses, and then the radial buses, which would land up at the Kendriya terminal, which is the central secretariat, and from there, you know, it would radiate outwards. And now that system is being replaced by the Delhi government to a system of feeder buses, where the ring road buses would ply as high capacity buses, and then there would be smaller RTV style buses which would then make smaller loops around those main stations like Dhola Kuan and further on to Najafgarh and so on and so forth. So it's kind of interesting that the idea of bus networks have, how they are evolving, because I mean BRTS is one way of decongesting cities and promoting bus services and public transport, but there are other ways as well. For a long time, Delhi had a very, very effective bus system. I don't know if you guys are aware that we have more than 550 bus routes in Delhi, and that these bus routes are organized in a manner that doesn't require a bus map. Not many people know this, but the bus numbers are supposed to give you a clue to where the bus is going and from where you are supposed to take a bus and where it would lead. I don't know how many of you are aware of this little nugget of information that you don't need. I mean, you can know by the bus number where the bus will go from and where it will reach. Did you guys know this?
About the bus numbers, yeah, that you just need to know which bus needs to go where. I think that system is kind of replicated in other cities like Mumbai also. Not sure if that's the same one, because I have used the system there, and it was the same thing, that you don't need to know the map.
No, but Mumbai, it will not work. I mean, the same numbering system wouldn't work. In Delhi, it works because of the kind of radial city that Delhi is. Mumbai being a linear city, it would not work the same way. But I'm talking about the numbering system, which uses the clock as a way of figuring out.
Oh, no.
You have zero at the center and you look at the numbers on the hands of a clock. And if you are, say that six is right on the south and three is in the east and nine is in the west. So if you have a bus number which says 680, then it's traveling from South Delhi, which is Mehroli, to 8, which is Munirka, and then 0, which is Central Secretariat. So this is kind of a system which existed for a very, very long time, which is very, very kind of interesting how it's done. And so the BRTS has been shifted. Well, the BRTS, which was promoted by the Congress and then denounced by the Aam Aadmi Party, and every government will bring their own system almost in some ways. But the study would also have benefited from understanding different kinds of bus systems, perhaps the BRT being one of them, that are operational across the globe.
Okay. Yes, sir. We can add that as a further view.
I think what you have studied as what your seminar topic says, BRT and the city, is that the topic?
No, that's not the topic. The topic is moving the masses and, you know, decongesting.
Yeah. So. Right. Making way for buses in the Indian roads. So, you know, my interest, I mean, truly speaking, you have presented the system of the BRT as a map and as a system, but as architects and designers, where the interface may be of great interest to all of us beyond, because the system is, let's say, it's engineered and it works well, etc. But the success of that system really lies in the design of it, when it has to deal with the complexity of other things, whether this is supporting something or it is being supported by other things. So that at that junction, if you can, where it meets the road, where it where it's an implanted, that is another study by itself.
Time limit.
So that you can just look at.
Yes, sir.
All right.
If there are no questions, then should I stop presenting?
Yes.
Thank you, sir, for your insightful feedback. I would now like to hand over the stage to Ayushi to introduce the next team.
Thank you, Joanne. As most of us are now aware, one major threat of global warming is the rising sea levels threatening the whole world. Coasts and coastal communities are proved to be the most affected due to the rising sea levels. Among the coastal communities as well, fishermen comprise a major percentage of the population. We now invite the next group with their study titled "The Effects of Rising Sea Levels on the Lives of Fishermen" and their findings as they look for new ways of tackling the situation through various case studies.
Thank you, Ayushi, for your kind introduction. Good afternoon to one and all. My name is Aditya M. Nair, and our topic is about impacts on the lives of fishermen due to rising sea level. Before going into the topic, I would like to introduce and extend our gratitude towards Professor Anjana Mittal and Architect Priyanka Kocha for guiding us. Now let me introduce my teammates, Harshil Gupta, Prashant Pal, Satish Kumar, and Swapnil Biswas. Without further ado, let's get into the topic. Carbon emission released into the atmosphere, which caused global warming across the whole world, which leads to melting of polar ice caps and expansion of water, which contributes to the rising sea level. Rising sea level is a major and serious issue at hand, and we have lost countless lives and properties every year due to rise of the sea. Still, people lack awareness about the issue other than the people who face it daily, which is why we have taken this topic, the rising sea level and its impacts on the fishermen. It will affect all the coasts and the people who reside in it. Among the population, fishermen being the majority, and their livelihood depends on the sea. It's affecting them on social, ecological, and economic level. We have taken up case studies to better understand how to tackle the situation and concluding with a suggestion to minimize the damage. This is our research question. How are the ecological, socio-economic aspects of the fishermen community being affected by the rising sea level, and what can be the possible solution to mitigate its impact? So through this research, we are trying to answer the question to the study. So we have taken a look upon the rising sea level on a macro to micro level and divided it into two parts, hardship from fishermen and strategies against rising sea level. And again, subdividing it into many parts. And we studied all these topics through research, case studies, interviews, and articles, and then analyzing the situation to form the conclusion. Rising sea level. Rising sea level is a major threat at hand, which will affect around 187 million people around the world by 2100. India is the second most affected country in the world. Almost 40 million people will be suffering from rising sea level by 2050. Not sure about how many more will be there. So we have taken the worst hit cities in India, and let's see the fate by 2050. Mumbai, Chennai, Kerala, and the worst case, West Bengal. Almost 30% of the West Bengal will be underwater by 2050. All these projections that you have seen is made with the current data available. But with current exploitation of the resources in the world, it will be a reality sooner than we expected. So to continue the presentation, I would like to call upon Harshil Gupta.
Thank you, Aditya, for passing me the opportunity. I would like to say more about rising sea level in micro level study. So we have taken upon coastal zones, which are more vulnerable to sea flooding and cyclone in respective cities. According to projection, 2 meter rise in mean sea level is predicted by 2100, and the red line on the image shows the projection of seawater level rise. When the seawater will cover the predicted coastal area,
the existing settlement will have to move further, leaving the setback for public safety, which would then reduce the habitable area furthermore. Chellanam, Kerala was taken as the first micro-level study as it is prone to highest sea level rise according to the projection in 2100. Second is the Marusa Beach, which is also a tourist destination, will also be affected in the upcoming year. Marthanda is a major densely populated village in Mumbai. It is a fishing village inhabited by the coli fishermen, popular for its quaint fishing business. Then comes to Sundarban. According to this projection, every area will suffer great amount of loss. Human settlements are often more concentrated in the coastal zone than elsewhere. Approximately 60 million of people live in low elevation coastal zones in India. We have studied settlement studies of the selected coastal region, and we found out from 2001 to 2021, many people from various parts of India migrated toward the coastline in a very short span of time due to economic benefit they get from coastal areas like access to ocean navigation, coastal fisheries, tourism, recreation. Here we can see the left image is the Google Earth image of the Sundarban in 2001, showing the very few settlement near the coastline. In the right hand side of the image, after 20 years of span, many settlement got shifted to Sundarban due to fishing and many other economic growth. From here onward, I would like to go through various places we looked upon. Goa, Chellanam, Kerala, Khardanda, Maharashtra. During the same time frame, the coastal area will continue to grow. New settlement will be built, particularly in these places, and more people would be. For more detail in the hardship of fishermen, I am handing over to Prashant to talk further.
Thank you, Harshit. Now, I'll begin with the hardships of the fishermen. India encompasses a 7,500 kilometer stretch of outline, accommodating 14 million fishermen communities who face the implications of the rising water level and its adverse impact on aquatic life. The ocean is the main source of livelihood of the fishermen, but the current situation doesn't seem to be in favor of them. Due to temperature change, additional frequent floods, cyclones, and destruction of their shelters, legions of people living in the coastal plains are prone to flooding. The effect of temperature change has damaged people and natural systems, including infrastructure, disturbed fish stocks, and has eroded natural resources and endangered species and ecosystems. Therefore, the global climate change is a threat to the health, happiness, and livelihoods of the people. Further, from one of the interviews with Bokul Mondol, one of the fishermen located on the coastal regions, we learned that the fishes and fishing communities are exposed to extreme weather events and natural hazards, such as hurricanes, tornadoes, rising waters, acidification of the oceans, flooding, and coastal erosion. The modified pattern of monsoon and cyclones has affected fishermen's daily jobs, as most of them are acting on a daily wage basis. And therefore, there has been a serious call on the number of days they get to travel within the ocean because of changes with monsoon patterns and the cyclones. Hence, they are facing a money hardship, especially the artisanal fishermen and small-scale aquaculture are particularly sensitive to these climatic changes. Next, what we learned is many tropical fish populations are already exposed to high extremes of temperature tolerance, and therefore some may be regionally threatened with the extinction and others may drift to higher latitudes. Increased development activities, coastal and marine pollution, and climate change's impact on ocean currents has accelerated the spreading of marine dead zones or oxygen dead areas, practically a region where fishes cannot survive. Therefore, there has been a reduction in the availability of fish along the coastal regions, and they need to migrate deeper into the ocean or migrate to a distinct region. In the next slide, rise in the sea level is gradually eating up the coastal land, and the remaining areas are constantly facing severe impacts of climate change. Therefore, the frequent flooding and increase in the height of the high tide on hitting the shore washes away the beach sand, reducing coastal land available for the fishermen community to dry up their fishes and carry out their daily chores. For further information, I would like to pass on the slides to Satish.
Thank you, Prashant. Now I'll be talking about resisting rising sea level. So the main important role in this cause is the role of mangroves. The aerial roots of mangrove forests retain sediments and stabilizes the soil in the areas between high tide and low tide by reducing erosion during storms and floods. The roots, trunk, and canopy of the mangroves can dissipate storm surges and waves. The main cause of mangrove loss in the world, as well as in Indonesia, which is our case study, includes conversion to stream ponds known as Blue Revolution, logging and conversion of land to agriculture or salt pans, and degradation due to oil spills and pollution. We'll see next that previous efforts to address the problem from building breakwaters and seawalls have failed. Some were too expensive, others were not able to adapt to the new and changing climate of the region. Seawalls or concrete barriers, the hard obstruction usually disturbs the incoming and outgoing strong waves. They erode more soil from underneath the walls and eventually they collapse it. In the next slide, we'll see about a case study from Dimak, Indonesia on how they are preparing themselves for this upcoming disaster. Rising sea level and sinking land threaten the Indonesian island of Java, which has lost 78% of its natural barrier, mangroves. But the result of a new project working with the island's natural landscape could help stabilize the coastline. We can clearly see from the image how the rise of water has affected the coastline, engulfing parts of the coastline as well as the lives of the fishermen. Once the seat of the influential sultanate, the district of Dimak in Indonesia is under threat. The island of Java as a whole has lost 78% of its mangroves, which once protected its low-lying coastlines from storms and erosion, according to the Westland International. In Dimak, this loss is compounded by rising sea levels and sinking land, the result of groundwater abstraction in a nearby city. The impact is stark, with a retreating coastline and many villages flooded and evacuated along 20 square kilometers of land. In long term, more than 30 million people in Java will be at risk from flooding and coastal erosion. Further, we'll see that how they are building with nature approach, which is a pilot project started in a small village, is now rebuilding 20 kilometers of mangrove coasts and involving local communities, government agencies, and educational institutes along the way. Unlike previous attempts, this work incorporates natural processes into water engineering practice. The first step in reviving the mangrove greenbelt, for example, was to restore sediment balance. Small-scale engineering techniques involving the use of permeable structures built along at the risk coastline allow suspended sediments in the water column to be trapped. Once sufficient sediment is retained, it can be used to expand the intertidal area, which is the space where the sea meets the land between high and low tides, and ultimately will create a new coastline. And now we'll see how the local communities are having this, they are owning these permeable structures, which have been built in phases and now stretch 9 kilometers. Their involvement and knowledge of construction, monitoring, and maintenance of the installation is crucial to the sustainability of this project. In areas where land subsidence makes mangrove restoration unfeasible, the permeable structures still hold the erosion-threatening villages along the northern Java coast. For now, the success of the Dimak project offers a bright new model for the rest of the country and the world. Handing over to you, Swapnil, to talk further.
Thank you, Satish, for your brief about the case studies. From here onwards, we try and implement the analytical study of possible and local solutions which might bring about hope to the approaching calamity. From the case studies we have taken upon with reference to Dimak, Indonesia, we might find that construction of biowalls and T-walls along the coastal regions may seem effective in many parts of India like Sundarban and Vasai. During major flooding calamity, it generally takes up to 100 meters of dense mangrove forest to wave down the height of incoming waves, since these trees have aerial roots and low branch heights. While in case of more open forest, it might take up to 500 meters of mangroves to reduce such incoming waves. Natural defense systems such as offshore sandbanks, seagrasses, coral reefs, dune, and salt marshes are also a major help to the attune wave and reduce storm impacts. The Indian government has already built walls along the coast, which were proven to have failed on many occasions, as discussed by my previous teammate Satish Kumar. Moving on, but constructing of these walls may act as a barrier to the fishermen on the sea. disrupting the connection with the sea and also to make it hard to access. Taking consideration from Indonesia, these barriers are intentionally kept permeable in order to allow the fishermen community to access the sea and also to reduce the impact of incoming waves without dampening the structural integrity of these physical walls owing to shear stress. In the next slide, we will see that on the top left corner of figure A, use of only mangrove trees as bio-wall protectors induces a dampening of 45% wave reflection, while the figure B represents a hybrid system of retaining walls along with bio-wall provides a wave reflection of almost 100%. Figure on the right-hand side depicts the graphical representation of the proposed strategies. To conclude the presentation, the problem tends to be very region-specific, thereby requires a local responses in action rather than depending on state or central authorities. Parts of Kerala and Mumbai are flooded every monsoon. This loss of human lives in and around the coastal wetland, which in turn also affects the ecological diversity of flora and fauna, and thus its productivity. To resolve issues such as immediate actions such as construction of bio-walls, T-walls, and maintaining an ecological mangrove barrier across the coastline is very necessary. To be quoted as coastal prisoners are the ones who have been duly affected by this alarming level of the rising sea level, being those social and economic of the residents. Entitled economic funding needs to be kept accounted for on both the national and the state level. Issues concerning inefficient relief resources is majorly caused due to lack of funding. Rising sea level are not part of the national climatic debate, and there is very little discussion in this issue in the National Climate Change Action Plans of 2008. Almost 187 million people will be hit by this calamity, and we need more efficient techniques and knowledge to deal with this existing crisis. Keeping in mind that many lives are at stake and necessary precautions need to be taken rather than dealing with the after effects once the damage is done. If not taken care of, the key to this immediate calamity is to be readily prepared for the most major migration of the coastal population in human history since the India-Pakistan partition of 1947, which was estimated to count of 14.5 million people. And with this, with all due respect, on behalf of our team, I would like to thank you all to be present here for your time and effort. With utmost sincerity, we hope that we could come up to your expectation. It would be grateful if you could kindly take 2 minutes to share your experience with our presentation. You can share your thoughts, ask questions, and we would like to try our best to revert back to you. Thank you.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to post their questions in the chat box.
Thanks for that. I thought it was a very pointed and very relevant topic that has escaped the attention of a lot of people. Like you rightly pointed out, it does not feature in the climate change debate, presently at least. I do feel also with the flooding of Chennai in the recent rains and other such cases, we will have to address this very, very soon. And of course, the fishermen, you've taken the lives of fishermen as a point of launching this debate or this discussion. It's a wide-ranging topic. But I'm glad that you've kind of focused on the fishermen and going on in their world. I'm still, actually, this is the one paper that I did not pre-read. So I'm still absorbing this a little bit. If Rahul has some comments before, Rahul, you could just come on this.
So one is when you're dealing with the fishermen community, they choose to live near the coastal bed. I mean, really at the last set of people who are living on the edge, because their livelihood depends on getting out to the sea. Is it also, are you also attempting, I mean, as a paper, to deal with urbanization along the edge and how to deal with that entire edge as a system to safeguard the city behind? So,
like, we have not got into that part.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
Right. So in the sense that the systems that you have shown of the two examples of the kind of built systems that can stop the flooding. I mean, there are other, I mean, if you were to expand it, expand this idea of how to safeguard the city behind from the flooding. And that is a larger research topic which can emerge out of it. And because internationally also that is a, it's not only in India, it's all over the world is an issue. And one is the natural systems of the local vernacular systems of how to safeguard it. But otherwise also there are other design solutions which are being all generated. So those projects could also be part of your learning and it could cross inform. Because fishermen community, yes, they are the ones who are living on the edge, but also the urban, I mean, at least in Kerala and in other places, because of being on the sea is premium, everybody wants to build as close to or reclaim as much of the sea edge as possible. So what is the limit and what kind of development it demands is can become the larger scope.
We are not saying that as the population goes high, there will be developments across all the has to happen on the seaside, because these people doesn't have anywhere to go else, because their lives in that depend on the sea, so they have to stay near to the coast itself. So every time whenever government there is a calamity happens, the government has just give the compensation for the loss and then back it up with some seawalls, which seem to be ineffective in many cases. So every time these things happen, we build inward. Like that's an exam. That's how they're thinking how we can resist the sea level. So what we are trying to do is that we can expand outwards to delay the rising sea level will happen. We're not saying that we cannot stop the rising sea level. The only thing we can do is that we can delay the effect. So by expanding to outwards, we can delay the effect and we can reduce the damages that can cause by this high tide and this raging sea.
You know, Aditya.
Yes, ma'am.
When you were researching right in the beginning, you were all very emotionally caught up with the fact that the government was, you know, allowing tourism to take over the places and all that, and they were not bothered about the fishermen and all. Now, if you had brought that into the discussion, then this plus the fact that they're not concerned about this climate change aspect would have helped you, no? Why did you drop that, considering you were so concerned about all of that? Why did you drop that completely?
At that time, we thought it was deviating from the main topic.
Up to a point, yes, but then if you had mentioned that, you know, they were using this time to push these fellows away and use this as for tourism, then it might have helped your concluding part where you're saying, you know, that there is not much concern, nobody's bothered about this aspect of climate change.
Ma'am, also to add to your point, I also feel, it's a bother that there is no resources properly relieved during this calamity. And every time calamities such as these happen, the government, they just release some funds and the authorities, they further distribute it down to the actual people who are down there. But they are, they have been lax. And in recent cases of West Bengal, there have been cases like the government have funded, but the fishermen actually didn't get the payment. So all these issues are also very much concerning, and which is why we also added the fact that there should be a state and the national level accounting kept for both the funding needs for future reliefs.
Yes, absolutely. This must come as part of your conclusion.
Also, ma'am, I would like to add something that this problem is also a region-specific problem. So, a preparation or awareness in the local people has to be made because like the people in Dimag, Indonesia, they have taken initiatives because there is awareness from the government side also. But if we take small groups who are like the funding is not reaching, but then also the calamity will reach them. So what we can do is, so where there are exploitation or if there is some political thing there, so there could be an education in that areas also, so that the people in those areas could take the initiative and with the use of the vernacular or the things or the materials that are available to them, they can have something which will save them to time till the time government or some like funding or something is there to help them to fight.
But don't you mention that these things have to be done in a local level?
Yes,
of course, certainly, you're right.
Ma'am, there is a like complete lack of knowledge about this issue. Like people who encode this daily knows this that there is an issue with the system and rising sea level. But other than that, as we go inwards, everyone doesn't feel that there is an issue. That there will be a lot of people around the coast who are in danger. So that needs to be discussed in a whole national level to make awareness. So people can come, either people can put forward many ideas, people can come up with many new things.
And it's you know, presentations like yours and papers like yours that will help this, make this awareness, you know?
Yes, and that's our plan, that's our idea to do.
Yeah. So Dipto Rahul, do you want to say something?
I was saying that, are you guys planning to convert this into a campaign or of sorts?
We have not planned yet, but we can do, we can give it a try, I guess. Because it needs to be known to people. It needs to be.
Yeah, I mean, of course, there's a concern over fishermen. Then there's a concern over technologies that can help resist the speedy deterioration of coastline. Then the third one is the whole aspect of climate change and rising sea levels. So there is. I believe there is the in the third part there is a lot of action that might be happening globally. There might be organizations like Greenpeace working on it, but at the micro level, whether there are NGOs who are working with the fishermen to safeguard their livelihoods and to safeguard their living settlement patterns and so on. But it'll be good to even kind of to have the various schools of architecture focus on such areas of the country where one could do measure drawing of an understanding of their settlement patterns and to figure out what's going on a yearly or a, you know, in 10 years, how they are moving inwards and so on. And I think this needs attention. And in terms of bringing this to the fore, you guys have done a great job. So congrats. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And we do hope that you'll take this forward a little bit because it needs to be taken forward into the next level because, you know, not stay within the confines of a limited audience.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir and ma'am, for your valuable feedback. At this point, I would like to ask the jurors and the faculty if we should take a break.
Yeah, Ayushi. We have a lunch break right now, but before that, we need to meet separately. The jurors and Ranjana ma'am and I need to meet separately in the breakout room.
Sure, ma'am. We'll arrange for that with the technical team.
It has already been arranged, so we can join. So, Rahul and Sudipta, please join this breakout room. You must be getting a notification. Yeah.
I request the audience to disperse for lunch. We all will rejoin at 2:15. Thank you.